Hare Krishna, welcome to this new episode of Chaitanya Charitamrita. We are continuing our study of the 6th verse of Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is explained in the 4th chapter, and we've already started the study of it, and we will be continuing from 4th chapter, 127th verse onwards. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. ओम ज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातम् सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजन सहितं कृष्ण चैतन्य देवं श्री राधा कृष्ण पादान सहगण ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितांश्च हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीनबंधो जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे. So welcome to this episode of Chaitanya Charitamrita. I'm sorry for that broken link of the, live stream. I got a bit late. There was some technical issue. The camera was not connecting. Anyway, I fixed it all up and we're good to go. So this is the verse we are actually studying, which is explained in the 4th chapter. So we'll chant this verse first and then we'll go to the explanation. श्री राधाया प्रणय महिमा कीदृशो वानयैवा स्वाद्यो येन अद्भुतमधुरिमा कीदृशो वामदीयः सौख्यं चास्यामदनुभवतः कीदृशं वेति लोभात् तद्भावाढ्यः समजनिशची गर्भसिन्धौ हि हरिन्दुः. So, what is this verse talking about? The threefold confidential reason of why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually appeared. So we know that he came for two reasons, one external reason and one confidential reason. The external reason is that he came to propagate the Yuga Dharma for this age. So the Yuga Dharma for this age is Harinam Sankirtan. So he came to propagate that. And the internal reason, the more confidential reason, is that he wanted to understand Radharani's love for him. That again is divided into threefold. What exactly he wanted to know of Radharani's love for Krishna? So the first thing is, desiring to understand the glory of Radharani's love, first. The wonderful qualities in him, in Krishna, that she alone relishes through her love, which he himself cannot relish. The wonderful qualities in him that she alone relishes through her love. And the happiness she feels when she realizes the sweetness of his love. To understand the glory of these things, The Supreme Lord Hari, richly endowed with her emotions, appeared from the womb of Srimati Sachi Devi as the moon appeared from the ocean. Now, these are actually very, very, very high, the highest subject matter of all religious understanding, this conjugal love. We are not in any way qualified to talk about it or hear about it even, but we have to know, because this is given in the Chaitanya Charitamrita and we are worshipping Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and we have to know at least, what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came for. At least for that reason we have to know. It's not that we can actually enter into this understanding at this point. At least I am not qualified at all. I mean, to say that I cannot understand is a very understatement. It's like I am not even close. So, Kanishtha Adhikari cannot understand Radha Krishna pastimes. Even Narottam Das Thakur, who is, Uttam Adhikari, he himself is saying that, when I have the mercy of Rupa and Raghunath Das Goswamis, then I can begin to understand Radha Krishna love. So, if Narottam Das Thakur is saying like that, who am I? So, it is not that we have great knowledge of these things, but at least we have to know. Whatever is revealed, we have to at least, theoretically know what is going on. Why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, what is actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mission? If somebody asks us, because we are Gaudiya Vaishnavas, and if somebody asks us, what is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, why did he come, and what is his mission? We have to know. At least for that reason we have to understand. Okay, so we stopped at this verse in our previous session. Nija prema swade mora hoye ahlada taha hote koti guna radha prema swad. So whatever pleasure I get from tasting my love for Srimati Radharani, she tastes 10 million times more than me by her love. The happiness, saukhyam chasa tadanubhavata kidrisham veti lobhat. The third line of the verse, of the main verse, explains this. So, what is the happiness that she is feeling? So, whatever pleasure I get from tasting my love for Srimati Radharani, she tastes 10 million times more than me by her love. So, Radharani is actually enjoying 10 million times more than Krishna. And it is said that the gopis who are assisting Radharani and Krishna, the Priyanarma Sakhis, the closest gopis of Radharani, they experience 10 million times more pleasure than Srimati Radharani by assisting Radha Krishna. They have a greater pleasure. And then the Manjaris and other gopis who are assisting them, they taste another 10 million times more than them. Like that it is going on. So, the when it is said, Dasa dasa anu dasa. We have to become servant of the servant of the servant. In this material world, the master of the master, the master of masters, he enjoys the greatest pleasure. But in the spiritual world, the servant of the servants, they enjoy the greatest pleasure.
Ami jai che paraspara viruddha dharmashray. Radha Prematai Chesada Virudha Dharma Moy.
Just as I am the abode of all mutually contradictory characteristics, so Radha's love is always full of similar contradictions. So, what are the contradictory characteristics of Krishna? Why Krishna said, I am the abode of contradictory characteristics? Then let's go to, at least reading about Radha's. Contradictions of Radha's love. So, what are the contradictions of Krishna's character? It's explained in Nectar of Devotion, summarized there very nicely. We have read this before, but again, for the purpose of this discussion, we can read this again. So, Krishna's personality is analyzed as Dhirodatta, Dhira Lalita, Dhira Prashanta, and Dhirodhata. If one asks how a personality can be beheld in four quite opposing ways, the answer is that the Lord is the reservoir of all transcendental qualities and activities. Therefore, his different aspects can be analyzed according to the exhibition of his limitless variety of pastimes, and as such, there is no contradiction. So, usually in this material world, a person is either Dhirodatta or Dhiralalita or Dhiraprashanta or Dhiroddhata. Maybe a little bit flavors of here and there can be found in specific situations, but the predominating personality of any person is one of these four. But Krishna has all four in fullness, not just like one in full and the other not so full. No, everything in full. Now you see, Dhirodatta. A Dhirodatta is a person who is naturally very grave, gentle, forgiving, merciful, determined, humble, highly qualified, chivalrous, and physically attractive. So, in this connection, the following statement given by Indra, the king of heaven, is very significant. My dear Lord, I admit that I have committed great offenses unto you, but I cannot express my feelings of regret, being bewildered at seeing your extraordinary chivalrous spirit, your endeavor to protect your devotees, your determination, your steadiness in lifting the great hill of Govardhan, your beautiful bodily features and your astonishing character, characteristic of being pleased simply by accepting the prayers of your devotees and offenders. The above statement by the King of Heaven is an exact corroboration of Krishna's being Dhirodatta. Many learned scholars have agreed to also accept Lord Ramachandra as Dhirodatta, but all of Ramachandra's qualities are also included in the character of Lord Krishna. Now, these are like this Indra's verse is actually an evidence of the Dhirodatta. So, for the next three, I will not be fully reading the evidence because it will take longer time. You can read it on your own, Nectar of Devotion, chapter 23. Krishna's personality, that is the chapter. Chapter 23 of Nectar of Devotion. So, Dhira Lalita. What is Dhira Lalita? A person is called Dhira Lalita if he is naturally very funny. Now, here Dhirodatta is very grave, gentle, forgiving, merciful, determined, humble, highly qualified, chivalrous and physically attractive. Now, here Dhira Lalita, he is naturally very funny, always in full youthfulness, expert in joking, and free from all anxieties. Such a Dhira Lalita personality is generally found to be domesticated and very submissive to his lover. So, this is Dhira Lalita. See? Quite very contrasting to the Dhirodatta position. Generally, those who are expert in writing drama choose to call Cupid the ideal Dhira Lalita. But we can more perfectly find in the personality of Krishna all the characteristics of Dhira Lalita. See that? Next, Dhira Prashanta. A person who is very peaceful, forbearing, considerate and obliging is called Dhira Prashanta. This Dhira Prashanta trait of Krishna was exhibited in his dealing with the Pandavas. So, you can read that. And Dhiroddhata. This is very contrast to the other three. A person who is very envious, proud, easily angered, restless and complacent is called Dhirodhata by learned scholars. Such qualities were visible in the character of Lord Krishna because when he was writing a letter to Kalayavana, okay, this is another, he insulted him. Then it is also said sometimes Bhima, the second brother of the Pandavas, is also described as Dhirodhata, easily angered, you know. But okay, you see here, there is a nice statement in the Kurma Puran about these contradictory traits of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It is stated there that the Supreme Person is neither very fat nor very thin. He is always transcendental to material qualities and yet his bodily luster is blackish. His eyes are reddish and he is all powerful and he is equipped with all different kinds of opulences. Contradictory traits in Krishna's person are not at all surprising. One should not consider the characteristics of Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, to be actually contradictory. One should try to understand the traits of Krishna from authorities and try to understand how these characteristics are employed by the Supreme Will of the Lord. So, all this, you see, his expanded bodies, this is from the Vishnu Puran, Vishnu Yamala Tantra. Here it is said, there is a statement that because the Supreme Personality of Godhead and his expanded bodies are always full of knowledge, bliss and eternity, they are always free from the 18 kinds of material contaminations, namely illusion, fatigue, errors, roughness, material lust, restlessness, pride, envy, violence, disgrace, exhaustion, untruth, anger, hankering, dependence, desire to lord of the universe, seeing duality and cheating. So actually the Lord does not have these imperfections, although sometimes he may seemingly put on such demeanors. So for example, Lord Narasimhadev, he was very, very angered, very restless, very, very seemingly very envious, you know, to tear open somebody's stomach and, you know, take out those intestines of a person, you have to be really fired up, you know, in your emotions to do that. So Lord Narasimhadev was emotionally completely charged and nobody could stop him, not even Lord Shiva and Lord Brahma, although Prahlad Maharaj could. Now that anger, although usually considered a bad quality, because it is used in protecting the devotees, he is worshipped as a supreme protector and he is worshipped in that Ugra Narasimha form, you see. So likewise, his so-called, you know, negative qualities, it's actually not negative qualities. When we have them, it is negative because we use it for our sense gratification. Whereas Krishna uses it to enhance his dealings with devotees. And anyway, even if it's for Krishna's sense gratification, that is rightly placed, because Krishna is the only one to be gratified. His senses are to be gratified. Rishikena Rishikesha Sevanam. Our senses are meant to satisfy his senses. So his sense gratification is actually lawful. That is what it is meant for. We are the ones who are supposed to cooperate with his sense gratification. Okay, so next, where were we? Yeah. So just as I am the abode of all mutually contradictory characteristics, so Radha's love is always full of similar contradictions. So Radharani's love is also full of similar contradictions, and the details of such contradictions are, I think, mentioned in a following verse or two verses after this.
राधा प्रेम विभुजार बाड़िते नहीं ठाए तथापि से क्षणे क्षणे बढ़ाए सदाए.
राधाज लव इज ऑल प्रोवाइडिंग लीविंग नो रूम फॉर एक्सपेंशन बट स्टिल इट इज एक्सपैंडिंग कॉन्स्टेंटली. सी इट सीम्स लाइक देयर इज नो रूम फॉर एक्सपेंशन बट स्टिल इट इज एक्सपैंडिंग कॉन्स्टेंटली. सो इफ ओके जस्ट टू रिफ्लेक्ट अ लिटिल बिट ऑन दिस. So, if Radharani's love, which is perfect, in fact, the word worship, Aradhana, comes from her name. So, if she is the perfect embodiment of all worship of Krishna, and if her service, although completely perfect, it's still, is expanding constantly. So, what about our service? So, we can just imagine how our service can be. There is always scope for improvement in our service. Even if we serve to the best of our capacity, it's never adequate. There's no such thing as adequate service to Krishna. Prabhu, I have done enough service, Prabhu, in this life. There's no such thing. If we think we have done enough service, that means it's as if we have repaid Krishna and repaid our spiritual master completely. Then we are an idiot if we think like that. So, we are minute. How small are we? Krishna, he is expanding in millions of Narayanas in the spiritual world. And one such expansion came to the material world, and that is Mahavishnu. And that Mahavishnu is expanding, and he has breathed out millions and trillions of universes. And in those universes, the smallest universe out of the many trillions is ours. And in that universe, there are millions and gazillions of planets. And in that one planet is ours, this earth. And in that one planet, there are thousands and thousands of cities and towns and, you know, and hundreds of countries. And in that, this, at least I am in Singapore. Singapore is a dot, basically. You can't even see it on the map, world map. And in that, there are millions of people. And in that, just I am one of the very 6 million people, maybe 6 to 7 million people. How small are we? So, how can we adequately serve Krishna? Never possible. But we are thinking we are big time. Although we are like the smallest of the small, we are thinking we are very big time. That is our problem. So we should just see from the Radharani's position, if her service has room for expansion, then there's nothing to be said about us.
जाहवाई गुरु वस्तु नाहि सुनिश्चिता तथापि गुरु र धर्म गौरव वर्जिता.
There is certainly nothing greater than her love, but her love is devoid of pride. That is a sign of its greatness. Usually, so anything we become great in this material world in any aspect, not just loving Krishna, that is the highest, but anything, even material things, if one becomes a little bit better than others, oh, immediately becomes proud. But there is nothing greater than her love for Krishna. But her love is devoid of pride. That is a sign of its greatness.
जहाँ होते सुनिर्मल द्वितीय नहीं आर तथापि सर्वदा वाम्य वक्र व्यवहार.
Nothing is purer than her love, but its behavior is always perverse and crooked. What is, you know, of course there are so many twists and turns to Radha Krishna loving affairs. Unless they are there, there is no drama, right? There is all for expanding rasa. I mean, in a very, very perverted way, this is shown in the movies of today, Hollywood, Bollywood. They will have some, you know, some kind of a love relationship going on between one man and woman. And then, of course, if everything goes good, that is too boring, right? So, there has to be so many twists and turns to the story, and that makes it some, you know, so-called interesting for the materialists. Now, in the transcendental relationships of Radha and Krishna, there are so many adventures going on. But it's not like the adventures of this material world, but, you know, in its own way, there's so much, and we are not very qualified to talk about this and discuss these things. But it is full of contradictions, transcendental contradictions. It's not like contradiction means, oh, there's some controversy. No, there's no controversy. So, this is from, I think, the Dhanakeli Kaumudi of Rupa Goswami.
Vibhurapi kalayan sadabhivriddhim gururapi gaurava charyaya vihina muhurupachita vakrima pishuddho jayati muradvishi radhikanuraga.
All glories to Radha's love for Krishna, the enemy of the demon Mura. Although it is all pervading, it tends to increase at every moment. So this is the kind of contradictions. See, it is all pervading, still it tends to increase at every moment. Although it is important, it is devoid of pride. And although it is pure, it is always beset with duplicity. Like for example, she is always thinking of Krishna. But in the presence of her elders, she'll behave as if she is not. She tries to hide her love for Krishna, but it shows. So many examples are there, sometimes very hilarious actually. They're described in Nectar of Devotion and Chaitanya Charitamrita. You know, she maintains to her family members that she has no relationship with Krishna. While saying that, she was wearing a necklace which was too big for her neck. It usually is good for a man. So basically it was Krishna's necklace. And she was arguing with her elders, no, I do not have anything. But the mother-in-law was looking at her necklace. I know what is happening. so many duplicitous behavior, you know. And many things, I mean, there's so many. I am not qualified to speak on it, but, you know.
Shay Premarar Sri Radhika Parama Ashray Shay Premar Ami Hoy Kevala Vishay.
Sri Radhika is the highest abode of that love, and I am its only object. Now, I want to bring to your attention these words of Ashraya and Vishaya. Now, if you remember, I think a few months ago, or 2-3 months ago, we have spoken about Ashraya and Ashrita. Ashraya is the shelter. Krishna is the shelter of everyone. And Ashrita means the one who is taking shelter, which is the devotee, which we are supposed to be. I mean, we are actually all are. we are either taking shelter of him directly or through his agency of Maya. It is the way we are Ashrita Tattva and Krishna is Ashraya Tattva. Now, we are not talking about that Ashraya here when we are talking about Ashraya. This Ashraya means the abode or the shelter of that love. Okay? So, don't confuse with this Ashraya with that Ashraya. That Ashraya Tattva means he is the shelter of everyone. He is maintainer of everyone. And everyone is under his shelter. That is one thing. But here we are speaking about love. When a person loves his beloved, the love is existing in this person, in him. And the beloved is the object of that love. The love is existing in this person for that person. So, the abode or the ashraya of that love is this person. And the vishaya or the object of that love is the other person, the beloved. Understand? So, now, with that understanding,
Vishaya jatiya sukha amaraswad ama hoite koti guna ashraya rahlad.
I taste the bliss to which the object of the love is entitled, but the pleasure of Radha, the abode of that love, is 10 million times greater. Now, Vishaya jatiya, relating to the object, sukha amar. So, the object of such love, which is Krishna, the devotee has love for Krishna. So, devotee is the abode of that love for the object Krishna. So, the ashraya of that love is the devotee. Now, Krishna is saying as the vishaya of that love, he is only entitled to the pleasure that is entitled to the object of the love. But the pleasure of Radha, the abode of that love, is 10 million times greater. Now, as we already have seen in the last session, Krishna says, I am the knower in everybody's body. Right? Kshetrajnam chapi mam vidhi sarva kshetreshu bharata. In the 13th chapter, 3rd verse, Krishna is explaining. So, he should know what is going on in Radharani's heart, but no, he doesn't know. And of course, when we say he doesn't know, oh, Krishna cannot do something. Yes, he cannot do something. But then he became Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and he did it. So, that also we have discussed last session. Now, but the pleasure of Radha, the abode of that love, is 10 million times greater.
Ashraya jatiya sukha paite manadhai yatne asvadite nari ki kori upai.
My mind races to taste the pleasure experienced by the abode or the ashraya. Radharani, but I cannot taste it even by my best efforts. How may I taste it? Krishna, this is all Krishna's thought process as he was contemplating to incarnate himself as Lord Chaitanya. These thoughts led to the actual incarnation of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, everything starts in the thought process. Like we also, if we want to start any endeavor, like if a businessman wants to start a business, first of all, he has to think about it, he has to brainstorm about it. And once an idea comes, then, you know, he has to see how to manifest that idea into action and, you know, a viable, tangible thing, business. And then he has to do some research and all these things. So, in this way, there was, in the same way, Krishna's business is not to open a business here and then, you know, of course, in one way, Bhaktivinoda Thakur has actually written a beautiful song on, what is that?
Bodo Sukher Khabar Gai. Bodo sukher khabar gai.
So that nice song is there, where it is explained that Nityananda Prabhu has opened a marketplace, a business, a shop, and he is selling the holy name for very, very little price. Everybody is welcome. All customers are welcome. There's a clearance sale going on, and he is just requesting little bit, you know, involvement, that's all. It's a very small price he's going to, he's ready to give. You can bargain like anything, come. You know, so Bhaktivinoda Thakur is behaving like an agent of that shop. Like, you know, an agent gets a commission. Now, if it's a shop and they are having some sale, and if there is one agent who is promoting the shop's products, So when he refers a customer to the shop will give this agent a commission. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur is inviting everybody, all of us, to come to that marketplace of the holy name, Namahatta. Namahatta means the market of the holy name. So please come and, you know, take, you know, this huge bargains to be had here. It's a huge sale going on, please rush. And he says in the song also that you become happy, Nityananda Prabhu also will become happy, and I will also take my due commission, and I also will be happy. So what is the commission that the devotee will take? When he sees, because he is paradukha dukhi and he is parasukha sukhi also. If others are happy, not illusory happiness. If others are happy in, by drinking, it's not that he is happy. But if they are actually happy, spiritually, in devotional service, in Krishna consciousness, then he is happy. Like in the morning we sing, Chaturvidha Sri Bhagavat Prasado Svadvanna Triptan Hari Bhakta Sanghan Kritvaiva Triptim Bhajata Sadaiva Vande Guru Sri Charanaravindam. So, the spiritual master is pleased when he sees the devotee is taking prasadam. Why? Because that means they have accepted Krishna, because they are what they eat. If they are eating prasadam, that means they are devotees. So by seeing them as devotees, it's not just that, oh, they are eating nicely, okay, I'm very happy, I feed them more and then make them fat. No, that's not the idea. The idea is that they are honoring the Lord's prasadam. Instead of eating any and every nonsense thing, they are eating prasadam, and the tongue is the most voracious of all senses, and they are endeavoring to control the tongue by eating prasadam. So when he sees this, that means, in other words, Atha Sri Krishna Namada Nabhaved Grahamindra Sevon Mukhehi Jihvado. The service to Krishna starts with the tongue. So when with the tongue they are having Krishna prasadam, that means all the other senses also will follow. So in that way they are becoming devotees. You are what you eat. So they are becoming devotees, and that brings great joy for the spiritual master. So that is a devotee. Parasukha Sukhi. So that is the commission that a devotee will take. And also Krishna says, there is nobody dearer to me than a preacher in the Bhagavad Gita, 18th chapter, 68th and 69th verses. So that blessings of Krishna, that happiness which he gets when he sees others happy in Krishna consciousness, that is the commission that a devotee takes. And Nityananda Prabhu is more than glad. He has opened up this marketplace. It's like an exhibition fair, you know. The fair only lasts a few days. And there are, you know, great discounts and everything. So similarly, Nityananda Prabhu has opened a great fair, and please come and take this most precious commodity, love of Godhead, which is distributing in the form of the holy name. Just take it. He is willing to bargain. I mean, accept your bargains. Whatever you ask for, he will give. He is very merciful. So I am also going to take my due commission. So like that he was. But his business is not to open like a business and exploit us. No. Krishna, when he comes, his business is to save us. So in that way, sometimes the exploits of Krishna and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and devotees are compared with the exploits of sense gratification. Like, for example, market. An ordinary market is where the businessman, he will try to get a profit from the customers. So the example is given in such a way, but the commodity is actually love of Godhead, which is basically, it's not something that Nityananda Prabhu will gain. No, the Lord has nothing to gain. So why should he open a marketplace? Nobody opens a shop if he doesn't want to gain anything from it. So this is the causeless mercy of the Lord. All those, and similarly, there is another nice verse in the 11th canto. Maya mrigam dhaitaye psitamanvadhavad vande mahapurushate charanaravindam. Now, tyaktva sudustyaja surev sitarajya lakshmim dharmishtha arya vachasa yadagadaranyam maya mrigam dhaitaye psitamanvadhavad Vande Mahapurushate Charanaravindam. So, O Mahapurusha, I worship your lotus feet. You gave up the association of the goddess of fortune and all her opulence, which is most difficult to renounce and is hankered after by even the great demigods. Being the most faithful follower of the path of religion, you thus left for the forest in obedience to a brahmana's curse. Out of sheer mercifulness, you chased after the fallen conditioned souls. This is the actual point I was trying to make. Out of sheer causeless mercifulness, you chase after the fallen conditioned souls who are always in pursuit of the false enjoyment of illusion and at the same time engaged in searching out your own desired object, Lord Shyamasundar. So you see, for example, when a lion chases a deer, that's an exploitation. I mean, the deer is going to suffer. Of course, it's majestic to see the lion chase. I mean, it's like a regal animal in the kingdom, in the forest. But what is happening there is actually pain. The lion is first of all painful because he is hungry. And the deer, his life is going to be lost. So, a chase in this material world is a very anxious thing, you know. But the chase of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, running after the fallen conditioned souls and catching them and giving them love of Godhead and making them devotees and sending them back, go home back to Godhead. So it is again compared with the exploitative mentality, but it's for good. In fact, there was a beautiful article or a speech, I think article, yeah, Srila Prabhupada wrote. He said, the Britishers have come to India and exploited the Indians, and they have taken so many valuable things from India, including the Kohinoor diamond and all those things. Prabhupada wrote like this, something to this effect. I'm just paraphrasing it because I don't know it verbatim, but this is what he said. I have a request for the Britishers. What is that? They forgot to take one precious thing from India. That is Krishna consciousness. So I beg them to come and exploit India again. But this time, spiritually. He's asking them to exploit. He's inviting the British to. He invited. He, in that article, beautifully written, he said, I request the British to come back to India and exploit India again and take the most valuable thing that they have forgotten here. They have taken so many things from India, but they have forgotten to take this one. So I invite them to come again and exploit India, spiritually this time, and take away this precious commodity, Krishna consciousness. He is inviting them to come and exploit. So, in this language, so it's very poetic. So, it's like a contradiction, exploitation, but actually it's a charity by Srila Prabhupada that he's offering. Please take. And a marketplace where it's profit, but actually it is charity again. So, sometimes such examples are given and it just adds to the poetic beauty of such expressions. So, anyway. So, Krishna is thinking, how am I taste this, you know, love? Kabhu jadi e premar hoi e ashray, tabe e premanandir anubhava hoi. If sometime I can be the abode of that love, only then may I taste its joy. Purport. Vishaya and ashraya are two very significant words relating to the reciprocation between Krishna and his devotee. The devotee is called the ashraya and his beloved Krishna is the vishaya. Different ingredients are involved in the exchange of love between the ashraya and vishaya, which are known as vibhava, anubhava, sattvika and vyabhichari. Vibhava is divided into the two categories, alambana and uddipana. Alambana may be further divided into ashraya and vishaya. I don't even know what these are, so don't ask me. Alamban may be, okay, this is what I have read. In the loving affairs of Radha and Krishna, Radharani is the ashraya feature and Krishna the vishaya. The transcendental consciousness of the Lord tells him, I am Krishna and I experience pleasure as the vishaya. The pleasure enjoyed by Radharani, the ashraya, is many times greater than the pleasure I feel. Therefore, to feel the pleasure of the ashraya category, Lord Krishna appeared as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Sorry. So that is nicely explained there by Srila Prabhupada, summarized everything there.
Eta chinti rahe Krishna parama kautuki hridaye badaye prema lobha dhakdhaki.
Thinking in this way, Lord Krishna was curious to taste that love. His eager desire for that love increasingly blazed in his heart. It just became more and more and more and more.
Ayekashuno ar lobher aprakar swamadhurya dekhi Krishna karena vichar.
That is one desire. Now please hear of another. So what is that one desire? The love of Radharani. The happiness that she wants to taste, that she is tasting. Then the other desire, seeing his own beauty, Lord Krishna began to consider. Now, what are the qualities in him that only Radharani is relishing and not even himself is able to relish or know? He is not able to know his own qualities from his own position. But Radharani is realizing something in him that he himself is not able to realize. So, what is that? Now, please hear of another. Seeing his own beauty, swamadhurya dekhi Krishna karena vichar, Lord Krishna began to consider.
Adbhuta ananta purna mora madhurima, trijagati har keho nahi payasima.
My sweetness is wonderful, infinite and full. No one in the three worlds can find its limit. This is not narcissism. Narcissism is when one is obsessed with oneself, way over the limit, like complete overestimation of oneself, you know, and overestimated obsession, you know, that kind of narcissism. So, but this is, when people are narcissistic, they're actually in an illusion. But Krishna, he's actually trying to find out, when Krishna thinks that's actually a fact. His sweetness is wonderful. There is a whole Madhurashtakam written by Vallabhacharya about how sweet he is. And infinite and full, that is fact. But if pride means when one has overestimation of one's own abilities, like he thinks he's too strong, you know, or too powerful, or that is overestimation. When one is not there and then one thinks he's somewhere. But this is a fact.
E prema dvare nitya radhika ekali amara madhurya amrita asvade sakali.
Only Radhika, by the strength of her love, tastes all the nectar of my sweetness.
Yadyapi nirmala radhar sat prema darpan tathapi svachhata tar badhe kshane kshan.
Although Radha's love is pure like a mirror, its purity increases at every moment.
Amara madhurya nahi badhite avakashe edarpaner age nava nava rupa bhase.
My sweetness also has no room for expansion, yet it shines before that mirror in newer and newer beauty.
Man madhurya radhar prema dohe hoda kare kshane 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 bade dohe keho nahi hari.
There is constant competition between my sweetness and the mirror of Radha's love. They both go on increasing, but neither knows defeat. Now, again, competition is another word which is usually found only in the material world. But actually, there is full competition in the spiritual world also. But here, the competition is for dominion or domination and putting down the other person. But here, the constant competition between Krishna's sweetness and Radha's love for his sweetness, each is increasing. So, it is compatible competition. Like, it's not an envious competition, you see. So, in fact, Srila Prabhupada also encouraged such competition between devotees in the matter of book distribution. So, if one temple distributes this many books, or if another temple, so when there is more competition, and who, which temple will distribute more books. Srila Prabhupada was very pleased with such competitions. You see? So each wanted to do more than the others. Like that, they were distributing millions of books, you know, back then.
आमार माधुर्य नित्य नव नव होय स्वस्व प्रेम अनुरूप भक्ते आस्वादय.
माय स्वीटनेस इज ऑलवेज न्यूअर एंड न्यूअर. डिवोटीज टेस्ट इट अकॉर्डिंग टू देयर ओन रेस्पेक्टिव लव.
दर्पणाद्य देखी यदि आपन माधुरी आस्वादिते होय लोभ आस्वादिते नारी.
इफ आई सी माय स्वीटनेस इन अ मिरर आई एम टेम्प्टेड टू टेस्ट इट बट नेवरदलेस आई कैन नॉट. Now, in this material world, everybody wants to look into the mirror and, you know, see their hairstyle and then how they look and everything. But Krishna also, where does that come from? It comes from Krishna. But you see how different it is. It is a pastime between Radha and Krishna. See how that got him when he saw his own reflection. That made him more and more wanting the position of Radharani. Because now he is looking at himself as if another person, as if he is another person.
Vichar koriye jodi aswada upay, Radhika swarupa hoyte tabe man dhay.
If I deliberate on a way to taste it, what is taste what? The sweetness of his own sweetness. I find that I hanker for the position of Radhika. So that's what Krishna ends up wanting. He wants the position of Radharani. Purport. Krishna's attractiveness is wonderful and unlimited. No one can know the end of it. Srimati Radharani alone can relish such extensiveness from her position in the Ashraya category. The mirror of Srimati Radharani's transcendental love is perfectly clear, yet it appears clearer and clearest in the transcendental method of understanding Krishna. In the mirror of Radharani's heart, the transcendental features of Krishna appear increasingly new and fresh. In other words, the attraction of Krishna increases in proportion to the understanding of Srimati Radharani. You see, the attraction of Krishna increases in proportion to the understanding of Srimati Radharani. Each tries to supersede the other, neither wants to be defeated in increasing the intensity of love. Desiring to understand Radharani's attitude of increasing love, Lord Krishna appeared as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then there is this beautiful verse from Lalita Madhava by Rupa Goswami.
Aparikalita purva kaschamatkarakari spurati mama gariyan esha madhurya puraham ayamaham apihanta prekshayam lubdha cheta sarabhasam upabhoktum kamaye radhikeva.
Who manifests an abundance of sweetness greater than mine, which has never been experienced before and which causes wonder to all? Alas, I myself, my mind bewildered upon seeing this beauty, impetuously desire to enjoy it like Srimati Radharani. Impetuous is the word, unable to control himself. So purport, this text is from Lalita Madhava 8th chapter 34th verse of Srila Rupa Goswami. Actually, Lalita Madhava is a drama written by Rupa Goswami. Two dramas like that. There is a Lalita Madhava and the, what is the other one? Vidagdha Madhava. Vidagdha Madhava is mostly his pastimes in, not mostly, it's about the pastimes in Vrindavan. And Lalita Madhava is his pastimes, a drama on his pastimes in Dwaraka. So this is from Lalita Madhava. When he was in Dwaraka, in the, you see, it was spoken by Lord Krishna when he saw the beauty of his own reflection in a jeweled fountain in Dwaraka. So in the jewel floor also it is said sometime. I think in another place it is said, maybe in the Bhagavatam or somewhere. So he saw his own reflection on the shining floor and he was also thinking like this. He wanted to enjoy that form. And there he had this mood of Radharani. So that there itself, when he was in Dwaraka itself, and here he was looking at the jewel fountain in Dwaraka, his own reflection. Again he was thinking like Radharani. that he wants to take the position of Radharani. So this contemplation on the on becoming or on incarnating as Lord Chaitanya happened already when he was in as Krishna here in this world. You see, when he was in Dwaraka, and when, you know, already he was thinking like that.
Krishna madhuryera eka swabhavika bal, Krishna adi nara nari karaye chanchal.
The beauty of Krishna has one natural strength. It thrills the hearts of all men and women, beginning with Lord Krishna himself. You know, there is that verse. Men and women. Nariyo narascha mudita kupita animescha, you know. Srimad Bhagavatam 9:24-65.
Yasyananam makara kundala charu karna bhrajat kapola subhagam savilasahasam nityotsavam natatrupur drishibhih pibantyo naryo narascha mudita kupitani mescha.
Krishna's face is decorated with ornaments such as earrings resembling sharks. His ears are beautiful, his cheeks brilliant, and his smiling attractive to everyone. Whoever sees Lord Krishna sees a festival. His face and body are fully satisfying for everyone to see, but the devotees are angry at the creator for the disturbance caused by the momentary blinking of their eyes. Okay, I think it was lost in the translation. But you see here,
Naryo Naraha.
All the women of Vrindavan and all the male devotees, all together.
Naryo Narascha Mudita.
They are all fully satisfied by looking at this beautiful features of Krishna. So he is attractive to both men and women. See? That was the point I wanted to show.
Shravane darshane akarshaye sarvaman apana aswadite krishna karena yatan apana aswadite krishna karena jatan.
All minds are attracted by hearing his sweet voice and flute, or by seeing his beauty. Even Lord Krishna himself makes efforts to taste that sweetness.
E madhuryamrita pana sadajay kare trishna shanti nahe trishna badhe nirantare.
The thirst of one who always drinks the nectar of that sweetness is never satisfied. Rather, that thirst increases constantly. When one what is that thirst? You see, shravane darshane akarshe sarvaman. All minds are attracted by hearing his sweet voice and flute, or by seeing his beauty, or by even his holy name for that matter.
Sir,
this is again another expression which is perverted in this material world. For example, in a desert, we want water, but the offering of a mirage is presented sometimes as an illusion. There appears like a huge body of water, but actually there is no water, it's just a mirage, it's an illusion. And the more one runs towards it, and the more thirsty one becomes. If you are supposed thirsty, and if you are taking something that is causing you to become even more thirstier, that is worse. But here, the thirst is increasing. I mean, nectar, you know, amrita, madhuri amrita, the nectar of sweetness of Krishna, when one takes it, the thirst is increasing, it is never satisfied. What does that mean? The devotees are never satisfied by looking at Krishna? No. They are so satisfied that they find themselves incapable, or they find themselves incapable and insufficient to taste the unlimited nectar that is being presented before them, and that's why they become dissatisfied. It's not that they are looking at Krishna and they become dissatisfied at Krishna. No. So it is about, okay, wait just a minute. I think position of the camera is, okay, that's a little better. Yeah. So they are dissatisfied because they are unable to fully hold or fully grasp the sweetness of Krishna. Okay, I think, wait a second. It's a bit tilted. One second. Sorry for that. Okay, so that is what they are dissatisfied with. Okay, that will be explained more in coming. But actually, I will show you one more verse which is not presented here. We have shown this verse quite a few times, but it's always good to revisit this. This is by Rupa Goswami.
Tunde tanda viniratim vitanute tundavali labdhaye karna kroda kadam vini ghatayate karnarbudebhya spriham cheta prangana sangini vijayate sarvendriyanam kritim no jane janita kiyad bhiramritai krishneti varnadvai.
I do not know how much nectar the two syllables Krishna have produced. When the holy name of Krishna is chanted, it appears to dance within the mouth. We then desire many, many mouths. You see, this is the thing that causes dissatisfaction. So Krishna is so beautiful. His name is so beautiful. So, what is that? Nectarian. That our one tongue appears insufficient or completely insignificant in tasting that in unlimited nectar. We then desire many, many mouths. When that name enters the holes of the ears, we desire many millions of ears. We desire, and when the holy name dances in the courtyard of the heart, it conquers the activities of the of the mind, and therefore all the senses become inert. This verse is included in the Vidagdha Madhava, a 7-act play written by Sri Rupa Goswami describing the pastimes of Sri Krishna in Vrindavan. You see? So, this is how the name of Krishna is so attractive. You see? So that is where the dissatisfaction happens. First, there is an intense desire that, oh, I want many millions of mouths, many millions of eyes, many millions of ears. But then, the devotee will face the reality. Okay, you know what? I have this great desire, but it's unable to be fulfilled. I don't have millions of eyes. I only have two to see the beauty of Krishna. And that two eyes also blink. And the eyes are covered with this, what is that? Eyelids, which block the vision momentarily. All these defects are there. So they become frustrated. They become dissatisfied. So this frustration, dissatisfaction is not actual frustration and dissatisfaction. It's a manifestation of ecstasy. So we should properly understand these things. So here.
Atripta hoi ha kare vidhira nindan avidagdha vidhi bhala na jane srijan.
Such a person, being unsatisfied, begins to blaspheme Lord Brahma, saying that he does not know the art of creating well and is simply inexperienced. So, such devotees who actually are expert relishers of the loving mellows of loving devotional service, they find fault with Brahma. See, when something goes wrong, we usually find fault with somebody, right? If you are frustrated about something, oh, he did not do this, he did not do that. You know, that is of course bad in the material world, if you always keep pointing fingers to others. But the devotee does this. I mean, not, we cannot imitate these things, but we first of all are struggling to chant our own 16 rounds. Like Prabhupada said, you know, finish 16 rounds and then put the bead back, and now I can do any damn thing I like. I have finished my quota for the day. Okay. He made a joke about the way we chant. So it's like, okay, one burden gone. Okay, now I can do any damn thing I like. Prabhupada exactly used the words, any damn thing I like. So that's our position. But these perfected devotees who are in this position of experiencing such great ecstasy, so they also seemingly behave like, you know, ordinary materialists pointing fingers here and there, and they point their finger at Brahma. They don't know who to blame. Brahma, blame Brahma. he doesn't know how to create, you know, he's inexperienced. Definitely he doesn't know how, definitely he doesn't have any knowledge of Krishna, which is why he created such imperfect instruments for seeing. Because if he really knew, then he would have given us millions of eyes. They speak like this, out of ecstasy. See, these are ecstatic outpourings.
Koti netra nahi dila sabe dila dui tahate nimesha Krishna ki dekhi bomui.
He has not given millions of eyes to see the beauty of Krishna. He has given only two eyes. And even those eyes blink. How then shall I see the lovely face of Krishna? Just imagine that much a devotee, a pure devotee is eager to see Krishna. Just, okay, these are very high topics, very elevated topics, you know, we are discussing these things. But, you know, we are not in a position to even understand these statements properly. But at least we can compare our position and see where we are in this whole picture. They can't even stand the blinking of eyes. That separation from Krishna, they cannot stand it. And they go to the point of cursing Brahma. I mean, just try to understand the kind of frustration they are feeling. It's not just like, how frustrating can it be? Just a blink of an eye, right? And it's finished and you can actually see again. But yugayitam nimeshena chakshusha prava. One moment is appearing like 12 yugas or 12,000 years, sorry. One yuga. So, in that way they are, you know, so anxious. That means to come to that state is called sandrananda. Sandrananda means intense happiness, ecstasy. And when one comes to that, so much that even one moment lost in disconnection from Krishna gives all utmost frustration. Whereas now, with all facilities, with our ears, with our eyes, we are, I mean, even while chanting, our mind is going a million places and coming back. We are chanting with our mouth, the mind is taking one huge around the world in 16 rounds. We are making 16, our hands are moving 16 rounds on the mala. The mind is moving 16 rounds over the earth. Although we are locked down in one place nowadays, still the mind is moving 16 times around the world. So, or maybe even 16,000 times, you know, by the time one round, I think 1,000 times we have revolved already. Okay, what is this verse? Oh, this is 10, 13, 20. Actually, this is very interesting. The same thing, same kind of expression is mentioned three times in the Bhagavatam, cursing the Brahma for stupid creation of the eyes. Atati yad bhavan ahne kananam. Okay, 11. What is the I think Damodarashtakatiyam can be sung for this, I guess. Atati yad bhavan ahni kananam trutir yugayate tvama pashyatam kutila kuntalam shrimukham chate jada udikshatam pakshmakridrisham atati yad bhavan ahni kananam trutir yugayate tvama pashyatam kutila kuntalam shrimukham chate jada udikshatam pakshmakridrisham. The gopis said, O Krishna, when you go to the forest during the day and we do not see your sweet face, which is surrounded by beautiful curling hair, half a second becomes as long as an entire age for us. Yuga. What is the word? Yugayate. Appears like a yuga. What is that? Truti. Half a second. Same thing by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Yugayatam nimeshena. One moment appears like a whole yuga.
And we consider the creator who has put eyelids on the eyes we use for seeing you to be simply a fool. Imagine calling Brahma a fool. I mean, Brahma has four heads and the biggest brains in the universe. And the gopis are calling him fool, you know, just like that. So, Sri Mukham. Pakshmakrit, the maker of eyelashes. And he's a jada, stupid. See, he's stupid. This was spoken by the gopis. This is another one. 10.82.39. I just shown you 9.24.65. You know, that was one. And 10.31.15 is another. And 10.82.39 is third time. गोप्यश्च कृष्णमुपलभ्य चिरादभीष्टं यत्प्रेक्षणे दृशिषु पक्ष्मकृतं शपन्ति दृग्भिर्हृदीकृतमलं परिरभ्य सर्वास् तद्भावमापुरपि नित्ययुजां दुरापम् एक्चुअली ऑल्दो दे सेड द सेम थिंग द इंटेंसिटी ग्रू इन 9.24.65 यू सी ओके बिफोर वी गो हियर We'll go to, let's go to 9.24.65. Shapanti means, you know. Okay, let's see. First they said, and then 9.24.65 it is said that they're angry. Okay, they have a feeling. It's just in a feeling state. But the devotees are angry at the creator for disturbance caused by the momentary blinking of their eyelids. First they're angry. Next. They said he is stupid. He is simply a fool, stupid. Now, here, Shapanti, curse. They cursed him. First they are angry, and then they call him stupid, and now they cursed him. The gopis saw their beloved Krishna at Kurukshetra after a long separation. They secured and embraced him in their hearts through their eyes, and they attained a joy so intense that not even perfect yogis can attain it. The gopis cursed the creator for creating eyelids that interfered with their vision. So 9.24.65, 10.31.15, 10.82.39. This text is from Srimad Bhagavatam 10.82.39. कृष्णावलोकन विना नेत्र फल नाही आन कृष्णावलोकन विना नेत्र ओह आई एम नॉट इवन गेटिंग दिस ट्यून कृष्णावलोकन विना नेत्र फल नाही आन जय जन कृष्ण देखे शे भाग्यवान देयर इज नो कंसमेशन फॉर द आईज अदर देन द साइट ऑफ कृष्णा हूएवर सीज कृष्ण सीज हिम is most fortunate indeed. Oh, another beautiful verse. Where is it even from? Oh, this text is from 10.21.7. अक्षण्वतां फलमिदं न परं विदामः ओके अक्षण्वतां फलमिदं न परं विदामः सख्य पशूननु विवेशयतोर्वयस्यैः वक्त्रं व्रजेशसुतयोरनुवेणुजुष्टं यैर्वा निपीतमनुरक्तकटाक्षमोक्षम् द गोपीस सेड ओ फ्रेंड्स दोज आईज दैट सी द ब्यूटिफुल फेसेस of the sons of Maharaj Nanda are certainly fortunate. As these two sons enter the forest surrounded by their friends, driving the cows before them, they hold their flutes to their mouths and glance lovingly upon the residents of Vrindavan. For those who have eyes, we think there is no greater object of vision. Perfection of the eyes. Mukundamala Sutra also has a similar verse and Bhagavatam also has, what is that?
1084. शिरस्तु तस्यो भयलिंगमानमेत् तदेव यत्पश्यति तद्धि चक्षु अंगानि विष्णो रथ तज्जनानां पादोदकं यानि भजन्ति नित्यं. व्हाट इज दैट? शिरस्तु तस्यो भयलिंगमानमेत् तदेव पश्यति, तदेव यत् पश्यति तद्धि चक्षु. Perfection of the eyes. Many places, I think we have shown over the past few sessions, similar verses. Then, like the gopis, one can see Krishna continuously if one is fortunate enough. In the Brahma Samhita, it is stated that sages whose eyes have been smeared with the ointment of pure love can see the form of Shyamasundar Krishna continuously in the centers of their hearts. This text from Srimad Bhagavatam 10.21.7 was sung by the gopis on the advent of the Sharat season. Now, you know that verse, right? Preman janachurita bhakti vilochanena santa sadaiva hrijayeshu vilokayanti yam shyamasundaram achintya gunaswarupam govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami. I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, who is Shyamasundar, Krishna himself, with inconceivable and innumerable attributes, whom the pure devotees see in their heart of hearts with the eye of devotion tinged with the salve of love. There's another verse in the Rigveda also. Om Tad Vishno Paramam Padam Sada Pashyanti Surayah Divivachakshuratatam Tad Vipraso Vipanyavo Jagravamsa Samindhate Vishnoryat Paramam Padam. Om Tad Vishno Paramam Padam Sada Pashyanti Surayah. The lotus feet of Vishnu and the abode of Vishnu are constantly visible to the devotees. Surayah. There are suras and asuras. The godly or the devotees and then the demons. So the devotees, the surayah, they sada pashyanti surayah, they always see. Wow, another Sanskrit verse. Bhagavatam 10.44.14 was spoken by the women of Mathura when they saw Krishna and Balaram in the arena of King Kamsa's great wrestlers, Mushtika and Chanura.
Gopyastapa kimacharan yadamushya rupam lavanyasaram asamor dhvamananya siddham drigbhipibantyanu savabhinavam durapam ekandadhama yashasa shriya aishwarasya. Beautiful verses, The women of Mathura said, what austerities must the gopis have performed? With their eyes, they always drink the nectar of the form of Lord Krishna, which is the essence of loveliness and is not to be equaled or surpassed. That loveliness is the only abode of beauty, fame, and opulence. It is self-perfect, ever-fresh, and extremely rare. What is that? Venum Gvanantam Aravinda Dalayataksham Barahavatam Samasitambuddha Sundarangam Kandarpakoti Kamaniya Vishesha Sobham Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. So, Kandarpakoti Kamaniya Vishesha Sobham, the beauty of Krishna. And another beautiful verse is also there, which is 10.21.5, which is just, if you go here.
Barhapidam natavaravapu karnayo karnikaram bibhradvasa kanaka kapisham vaijayantim chamalam randhran veno radharasudhaya purayangopa vrindair vrindaranyam swapadaramanam pravishad gita kirtihim. Wearing a peacock feather ornament upon his head, blue karnikar flowers on his ears, a yellow garment as brilliant as gold, and the Vaijayanti garland, Lord Krishna exhibited his transcendental form as the greatest of dancers as he entered the forest of Vrindavan, beautifying it with the marks of his footprints. He filled the holes of his flute with the nectar of his lips, and the cowherd boys sang his glories. So this is the The gopis remembered all the transcendental qualities of Krishna mentioned in this verse. So Krishna's artful way of dressing and the beautiful blue flowers placed over his ears excited the gopis' romantic desires, and as he poured the nectar of his lips into his flute, they simply lost themselves in ecstatic love for him. So these are the verses.
अपूर्व माधुरी कृष्णेर अपूर्व तार बाल जाहर श्रवणे मन होए टलमल.
द स्वीटनेस ऑफ लॉर्ड कृष्णा इज अनप्रेसिडेंटेड एंड इट्स स्ट्रेंथ इज ऑल्सो अनप्रेसिडेंटेड. सिंपली बाय वन्स हियरिंग ऑफ सच ब्यूटी द माइंड बिकम्स अनस्टेडी.
कृष्णेर माधुर्य कृष्ण कृष्णेर माधुर्य कृष्णे उपजय लोभ सम्यग आस्वादिते नारे मने रहे क्षोभ.
Lord Krishna's own beauty attracts Lord Krishna himself, but because he cannot fully enjoy it, his mind remains full of sorrow. Oh, Krishna's mind is full of sorrow now. Again, the sorrow is not an actual sorrow, it's a feeling of ecstasy.
Eta hetur kahilo vivaran tritiya heture beshu naha lakshan.
This is a description of his second desire. Now please listen as I describe the third. First is the sweetness or the happiness that Radharani experiences. Next, his own sweetness. Now the third.
Atyanta nigudha era sera siddhanta swarupa gosai matra janena ekanta.
This conclusion of rasa is extremely deep. Only Swarup Damodar knows much about it.
जे बागे हो अन्य जाने से होता हा होते चैतन्य गोसाइर ते हो अत्यंत मर्म जाते.
Anyone else who claims to know it must have heard it from him, from Swarup Damodar, for he was the most intimate companion of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu.
गोपीगणेर प्रेमेर रूढ़ भावनाम विशुद्ध निर्मल प्रेम कभु नहि काम.
The love of the gopis is called Rudha Bhava. It is pure and spotless. It is not at any time lust. Now, a very nice explanation is given in these few verses about the love of the gopis that they have for him, for Krishna. It is called Rudha Bhava. It is pure and spotless. It is not at any time lust. Now, the difference between love and lust is very nicely explained in the few verses here. Purport. As already explained, the position of the gopis in their loving dealings with Krishna is transcendental. Their emotion is called Rudha Bhava. Although it is apparently like mundane sex, one should not confuse it with mundane sexual love, for it is pure and unadulterated love of Godhead.
Premaiva goparamanam kama ityagamat pratham ityu इत्युद्धवादयोप्येतं वांछन्ति भगवत्प्रियाः.
The pure love of the gopis has become celebrated by the name lust. The dear devotees of the Lord, headed by Sri Uddhava, desire to taste that love. This is a verse from the Bhaktirasamrita Sindhu 1.2.285 by Rupa Goswami.
काम प्रेम दोहाकार विभिन्न लक्षण लौह आर हेम जय छे स्वरूपे विलक्षण लौह आर हेम जय छे स्वरूपे विलक्षण.
सो लस्ट एंड लव हैव डिफरेंट कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स जस्ट एज आयरन एंड गोल्ड हैव डिफरेंट नेचर्स. नाउ आयरन एंड गोल्ड देयर इज नो कंपैरिजन लाइक दैट. देयर इज नो कंपैरिजन बिटवीन लस्ट एंड लव. Purport. One should try to discriminate between sexual love and pure love, for they belong to different categories with a gulf of difference between them. They are as different from one another as iron is from gold. This is the famous verse.
Atmendriya priti vancha tare balikam krishnendriya priti ichha dhare premanam.
The desire to gratify one's own senses is kama, lust, but the desire to please the senses of Lord Krishna is prema, love. Now, why are we talking about this? We are supposed to talk about the third reason of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, right? What are we talking about suddenly? No, it's all connected. So, because he wants to explain Radharani's love for him. What is the nature of Radharani's love? The greatness of Radharani's love. Because we've already touched upon the topics of what is the happiness that she feels and what are the qualities in him that Srimati Radharani alone relishes. Now, the other thing, which is actually the first reason mentioned, Radha, what is that? Shri Radhaya Pranaya Mahima Kidrisho Vanayaiva. The first line of the verse. Pranaya Mahima Radhaya. Shri Radhaya Pranaya Mahima Kidrisho Vanayaiva. What is the nature of Radharani's love? To make us understand, have at least a glimpse of the understanding of Radharani's love, he is explaining first of all what is lust and love, because it is easily misunderstood. At least now we are talking about some topic which we can comprehend, lust. Because all these topics until now, you know, Radha Krishna and all that, very, very high elevated topic. We can just read about it and, you know, just accept them. But this is something which we can comprehend. Krishna Atmendra Pritivancha Tarevalikam, Krishnendra Pritichha Dhare Premna. The desire to gratify one's own senses is karma, lust. But the desire to please the senses of Lord Krishna is prema, love. The revealed scriptures describe pure love as follows. Oh, wow. There is a nice verse. What is this? Where is it from even? Not mentioned. Sarvatha dhvamsa rahitam satyapidhvamsa karane yadbhava bandhanam yunoh saprema parikirtitaha. Oh, I always knew this thing, but I never knew it was a verse. Of course it is a verse. If there is ample reason for the dissolution of a conjugal relationship, if there is ample reason for the dissolution of a conjugal relationship, and yet such a dissolution does not take place, such a relationship of intimate love is called pure. There is every reason that the relationship should break. But if it doesn't break, despite everything, despite all the ingredients of a breakup, if it doesn't break up, yes, then that is pure love. Like Radharani explains in the, even in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he explained in the Shikshashtaka, he called Krishna as Lampata. Lampata means a debauchee who seemingly appears as if he is faithful to his beloved, but then he has other affair. So Radharani says in the Antilila 20th chapter, last chapter of Chaitanya Charitamrita, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is actually recollecting Radharani's mood. And she says that even if Krishna enjoys with other gopis in front of me, I still that doesn't change my mind about him. He's still the Lord of my life. Nothing, whatever he does, he can do. But it will still not change. That strong. No. Sarvatha dhvamsa rahitam satyapidhvamsa karanem yadbhava bandhanam yuno saprema parikirtitah. The predominated gopis were bound to Krishna in such pure love. For them, there was no question of sexual love based on sense gratification. Their only engagement in life was to see Krishna happy in all respects, regardless of their own personal interests. They dedicated their souls only for the satisfaction of the personality of Godhead Sri Krishna. There was not the slightest tinge of sexual love between the gopis and Krishna. The author of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita asserts with authority that sexual love is a matter of personal sense enjoyment. All the regulative principles in the Vedas pertaining to desires for popularity, fatherhood, wealth and so on are different phases of sense gratification. Acts of sense gratification may be performed under the cover of public welfare, nationalism, religion, altruism, ethical codes, biblical codes, health directives, fruitive action, bashfulness, tolerance, personal comfort, liberation from material bondage, progress, family affection or fear of social ostracism or legal punishment. But all these categories are different subdivisions of one substance, sense gratification. All such good acts are performed basically for one's own sense gratification, for no one can sacrifice his personal interest while discharging these much advertised moral and religious principles. But above all, this is a transcendental stage in which one feels himself to be only an eternal servitor of Krishna, the Absolute Personality of Godhead. All acts performed in this sense of servitude are called pure love of God because they are performed for the absolute sense gratification of Sri Krishna. However, any act performed for the purpose of enjoying its fruits or results is an act of sense gratification. Such actions are visible sometimes in gross and sometimes in subtle forms. Sometimes gross sense gratification is like gross sense gratification. Subtle sense gratification is just, you know, in the mind. They want to enjoy, they want to have some fame or some adoration. These are all in the mind, not immediately visible. You see, not tangibly visible, but you can get the indication by the behavior of a person.
Kamera tatparya nija sambhoga keval Krishna sukta tatparya matra premata prabal. Krishna sukha tatparya matra premata prabal.
The object of lust is only the enjoyment of one's own senses, but love caters to the enjoyment of Lord Krishna, and thus it is very powerful. This is
Loka dharma, Veda dharma, Deha dharma karma, Lajja dhairya, Deha sukha, Atma sukha marma, Dustyaja arya patha, Nija parijan, Svajane karaye jata, Taran bhartsana, Sarvatyagi kore kore, Krishnera bhajan, Krishna sukha hetu kore, Prema sevan.
So, Krishna said in Bhagavad Gita, Sarvadharman Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Vraja. Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. Now, Sarvadharman, what are the dharmas? Loka dharma, Veda dharma, Deha dharma karma, Lajja dhairya, Deha sukha, Atma sukha marma, Dustyaja arya patha, Nija parijan, Svajane karaye jata, Tadana bhartsan, Sarvatyagi kare kari, Krishnera bhajan, Krishna sukha hetu kare, Prema sevan.
Social customs, scriptural injunctions, bodily demands, fruitive action, shyness, patience, bodily pleasures, self-gratification, and the path of varnashram, dharma, which is difficult to give up. The gopis have forsaken all these along with their families and suffered their relatives' punishment and scolding, all for the sake of serving Lord Krishna. They render loving service to him for the sake of his enjoyment. इहा के कहिए कृष्णे दृढ़ अनुराग स्वच्छ धौत वस्त्र जैसे ना ही कौन दाग.
That is called firm attachment to Lord Krishna. It is spotlessly pure, like a clean cloth that has no stain. Although it looks full of stains, like gopis, oh, there you are running after another man. Oh, that is, oh, this is debauchery. This is extramarital affair. But actually, Krishna is the supreme lord of everyone. Even the most chaste woman, she is chanting Hare Krishna, right? Even devotee women, they are chanting Hare Krishna. Does it mean they are lusting after somebody other than the husband? Are they termed as unchaste? No. Because Krishna is the actual, Krishna is God, right? Supreme Personality of Godhead, and everybody must worship God. Whether it is the husband or wife and everybody. So when one is worshipping Krishna and chanting his name, it is not that she is cheating on the husband. Actually, it is not, although it looked like that when the gopis were there and they were dancing with Krishna. Actually, what are they doing? They are chanting Krishna's name, they are thinking about Krishna. That is actually worship of Krishna. You see? It's not a loss of chastity. In fact, it is very, very chaste. In fact, we all have been unchaste. We are supposed to be chaste to Krishna, but we have become unchaste. So, if one is actually thinking of Krishna, he is the most chaste. When I say he, because we are all actually female in one sense. In Prakriti, in spiritual, we are all Prakriti, female. So, we are actually supposed to be chaste. And if one thinks of Krishna, he is actually the most chaste person. अव्यभिचारिणी भक्ति, दैट वर्ड इज यूज्ड इन भगवद्गीता 14:26, माम जयो व्यभिचारेण भक्ति योगेन सेवते, हुएवर थिंक्स ऑफ मी एंड अनडिविएटेड अव्यभिचारेण, व्यभिचारी मीन्स यू नो फिकल, लाइक अ प्रॉस्टिट्यूट, प्रॉस्टिट्यूट इज कॉल्ड फिकल माइंडेड बिकॉज she stays with one man every other day or every day or many men in one day, so she hops from one man to another, she's not chaste. So we have been like that, like prostitute. Instead of being chaste to Krishna, we have been hopping from one, you know, in that way we have been having so many relationships in trillions of lifetimes. See, so actually one who is Krishna conscious, he is the most, that's why you see स्वच्छ धौत वस्त्रे जयछे नाही कोन दाग, इट इज स्पॉटलेसली प्योर लाइक अ क्लीन क्लॉथ दैट हैज नो स्टेन, बट आयन इज दैट इट लुक्स लाइक फुल ऑफ स्टेन्स, यू नो, एंड वन लीव्स फैमिली एंड जॉइन्स कृष्णा कॉन्शियसनेस, ओ दैट इज बैड, यू नो, ही डिड नॉट लिसन टू हिज फादर, सो इट इज ऑलवेज क्रिटिसाइज्ड, बट एक्चुअली इट इज द मोस्ट प्योरेस्ट थिंग, इट इज क्रिटिसाइज्ड बाय दोज हु आर इम्प्योर, हु आर यूज्ड टू इम्प्योर लाइफ. Such people criticize pure life. Purport. That is also mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita actually, 269. Ya anisha sarva bhutanam tasyam jagrati samyami yasyam jagrati bhutani sanisha pasyato munehem. What is night for all beings is the time of awakening for the self-controlled, and the time of awakening for all beings is night for the introspective sage. So whatever, it's like a difference between day and night. So what the materialists are considering pure and worthy, the spiritualists have no interest in that. And what the spiritualists consider worthy, the materialists are not interested in that. And they criticize each other. But the spiritualists are always right. Because they are spiritual, when I say spiritualists means not this new age spiritualism nonsense rubbish, I'm talking about devotees. Only devotees are actually spiritually situated. The so called people who say they are spiritual or new age spiritualism and all this, they are just on the mental platform, on the mind platform. They have to rise to intelligence and finally to the spirit soul platform. Only devotees are engaged in actual spiritual platform. Purport of 4.170 of Chaitanya Charitamrita. The author of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita advises everyone to give up all engagements of sense gratification and, like the gopis, dovetail oneself entirely with the will of the Supreme Lord. That is the ultimate instruction of Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. We should be prepared to do anything and everything to please the Lord, even at the risk of violating the Vedic principles or ethical laws. Look at that. That is the standard of love of Godhead. Such activities in pure love of Godhead are as spotless as white linen that has been completely washed. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur warns us in this connection that we should not mistakenly think that the idea of giving up everything implies the renunciation of duties necessary in relation to the body and mind. It is not exactly renunciation of duties necessary in relation to body and mind, although material. Even such duties are not sense gratification if they are undertaken in a spirit of service to Krishna. So in other words, for example, having a family, it's not condemned as long as it is used for Krishna. We should not use, the other day also I was saying this in the Bhagavatam class, that we should not, a family person, usually they pray to Krishna, or even like devotees also, those who are not experienced in full-time devotional service, they tend to take Krishna consciousness as a means of, basically it's not complete surrender. They want to continue in their own materialistic way of life and be devotees at the same time, chant Hare Krishna a little bit, 16 rounds and all that, but still interested in materialistic way of life. That should not be the way. One should always think how to engage everything in Krishna service. It's not my family, it is Krishna's family. They are all not my family members, Krishna's family members, Krishna's devotees, and I have to engage them. And that's why even the children, especially it comes down to this point where the parents, even devotees, don't want their children to become a full-time dedicated devotees, unnecessarily mislead them into a whole materialistic way of life. And the children, I mean, Prabhupada said the children who are born to devotees, they are Vaikuntha children, they have this huge opportunity of going back to Krishna in this lifetime. And the parents have the facility or have the opportunity to serve such souls and guide them on the proper, in the proper direction. But unfortunately, many times it so happens that devotees of children become deviated from the path and end up as materialists, and they behave just like, almost like a newcomer. You know, a newcomer comes and maybe donates a little bit, and you know, that's how he starts. I mean, everybody starts somewhere, right? So, but we have to progress on from there. But a person who has been born in a devotee, as a devotee's family member, and then he behaves like an ordinary newcomer, that's actually a degradation, not a, it's a regression, not a progression. So, we have to take advantage of that. Great. Why did a person be born in a devotee family? Because he has started his devotional life and not, you know, finished it. But if this opportunity is not taken advantage of, and then immediately, I mean, eventually we lose the opportunity. If we throw away the opportunity of becoming a devotee, then, you know, it's regrettable, right? So, that's why we have to become very careful and attentive, and we would always consider the good fortune that we have, with it. We are in connection with Krishna's movement, Hare Krishna, this a method by which we can go back to Godhead, you know, and not to lose this chance.
Atayeva kama preme bahuta antar, kama andhatama prema nirmala bhaskar.
Therefore, lust and love are quite different. Lust is like dense darkness, but love is like the bright sun.
Ata eva gopi ganer nahi kama gandha, Krishna sukha lagi matra Krishna se sambandha.
Thus, there is not the slightest taint of lust in the gopi's love. Their relationship with Krishna is only for the sake of his enjoyment.
यत्ते सुजात चरणं बुरुहं स्तनेषु भीता शनैः प्रियदधीमहि कर्कशेषु तेनाटवीमटसि तद्व्यथते न किं स्वित् कूर्पादिभिर्भ्रमति धीर्भवदायुषां नः.
ओ डियर्लि बिलवेड, दिस् द गोपी इस् एक्चुअली टॉकिंग टू कृष्ण. Your lotus feet are so soft that we place them gently on our breasts, fearing that your feet will be hurt. You know, actually breasts are nothing but fat, and you know, it's not a hard bone or something like that. But still they are feeling like that our breasts are too hard for your lotus feet. The gopis are thinking like this. Because actually Krishna's feet are so soft, in fact it is said that it is so soft that when some grass, the blade of grass touches his feet will become red at that place. So soft, so delicate. Oh, dearly beloved, your lotus feet are so soft that we place them gently on our breasts, fearing that your feet will be hurt. Our life rests only in you. Our minds therefore are filled with anxiety that your tender feet might be wounded by pebbles as you roam about on the forest path. So, Krishna is going, herding the cows, and the gopis are worrying that his feet are going to be, you know, so many thorns and pebbles and so many things in the forest. I mean, forest is not a smooth place. There is no paved roads or, you know, footpath, you know, walking path, nothing. So, they are thinking like this. So, always they are constantly in anxiety. This text from Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken by the gopis when Krishna left them in the midst of the Ras Leela. Oh, this is actually Rasila also was in the garden, you know, like a forest, and then he went away somewhere. Then they were thinking like this.
Atma sukha dukhe gopir nahika vichar, Krishna sukha hetu cheshta mano vyavahar.
The gopis do not care for their own pleasures or pains. All their physical and mental activities are directed toward offering enjoyment to Lord Krishna. I think we all know the Krishna's headache story. So, they do not care for their pain or whether they are going to hell or what. They just want Krishna to be happy. That's all they want. they don't care about anything else.
कृष्ण लागी आर सब करे परित्याग कृष्ण सुख हेतु करे शुद्ध अनुराग
दे रिनाउंस एवरीथिंग फॉर कृष्ण दे हैव प्योर अटैचमेंट टू गिविंग कृष्ण प्लेजर 10:32-21 स्पोकन बाय कृष्ण व्हेन ही रिटर्न टू द एरिना ऑफ द रासलीला
एवं मदर्थोज्झितलोक वेद स्वानाम हि वो मयि अनुवृत्तये बलाः मया परोक्षं भजता तिरोहितं मासूयितुं मार्हत तत्प्रियं प्रियाः स्वानाम हि वो मयि अनुवृत्तये बलाः
सो एक्चुअली दिस इज बेटर इन द दामोदरष्टकम् ट्यून् विच् इस्
एवं मदर्थोज्झितलोकवेद स्वानां हि वो मयि अनुवृत्तये बलाः मया परोक्षं भजतातिरोहितं मासूयितुं मार्हत तत्प्रियं प्रियाः
ओ बिलवेड् ओ मै बिलवेड् गोपीस् यू हेव् रिनौन्स्ड् सोशल् कस्टम्स् स्क्रिप्चुरल् इञ्जङ्क्षन्स् and your relatives for my sake. I disappeared behind you only to increase your concentration upon me. Since I disappeared for your benefit, you should not be displeased with me. This text from Srimad Bhagavatam 10.32.21 was spoken by Lord Krishna when he returned to the arena of the Rasalila. Now, this kind of reciprocation by Krishna, a seeming lack of reciprocation. See, when one disappears, it is like a, you know, nowadays it is called ghosting. Ghosting means, you know, they don't reciprocate at all. They don't reply to your message. It's called ghosting. So, Krishna ghosted them. And that is actually, like Krishna is explaining here, it's a reciprocation to increase their love for him. And this same thing happened to Narad Muni also. If you remember, Srimad Bhagavatam, let me see if I can. It's in the fifth chapter, though. Okay, let's see. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 1, Chapter 5. Go. No, not this. Why is that? Oh, 25. Well, actually, there is you know, Narad Muni says this, that in his previous life, he was this boy, Sudra and his son, and he saw Krishna only once, and Krishna disappeared from him. So, and after that, he never saw him. So, that actually, because he saw him once, that taste, that happiness, I mean, he wanted to have that vision again, but no, Krishna did not allow it because he wanted to increase that. If you can find, maybe you can share in the comments where exactly that verse is. We can, you know, take it out on the screen here. So, in that way, Krishna actually increased the desire of Narad Muni. At that time, he was not Narad Muni. He was just a Sudrani's son in the previous life. And because of that, he became Narad Muni. So, that's how Krishna reciprocates by disappearing also. By not seemingly reciprocating, he's actually reciprocating. That is the omni presence and omniscience of Krishna. When we don't reciprocate to someone, there is actually a lack of reciprocation. But when Krishna does it, it's also reciprocation. See, as Krishna himself explained.
कृष्णेर प्रतिज्ञा एक आछे पूर्व होते जे जय छे भजे कृष्ण तारे भजेताय छे.
लॉर्ड कृष्णा हैज अ प्रॉमिस बिफोर सॉरी लॉर्ड कृष्णा हैज अ प्रॉमिस फ्रॉम बिफोर टू रेसिप्रोकेट विद हिज डिवोटीज अकॉर्डिंग टू द वे दे वर्शिप हिम. इन द भगवद गीता ही सेज दैट या दिस इज द वर्स.
ये यथा माम प्रपद्यन्ते तामस्तथैव भजाम्यहं मम वर्तमानुवर्तन्ते मनुष्याः पार्थ सर्वशः.
इन व्हाटएवर वे माय डिवोटीज सरेंडर अन टू मी आई रिवॉर्ड देम अकॉर्डिंगली. Everyone follows my path in all respects, O son of Pritha. So, purport. Krishna was never ungrateful to the gopis, for as he declares to Arjuna in this verse from the Bhagavad Gita 4.11, he reciprocates with his devotees in proportion to the transcendental loving service they render unto him. Everyone follows the path that leads toward him, but there are different degrees of progress on that path, and the Lord is realized in proportion to one's advancement. The path is one, but the progress is in approaching the ultimate goal is different, and therefore the proportion of realization of this goal, namely the absolute personality of Godhead, is also different. The gopis attained the highest goal, and Lord Chaitanya affirmed that there is no method of worshipping God higher than that followed by the gopis.
She pratignya bhanga hoilo gopira bhajane. ताहते प्रमाण कृष्ण श्रीमुख वचने.
प्रतिज्ञा भंग होइलो. दैट प्रॉमिस हैज बीन ब्रोकन बाय द वर्शिप ऑफ द गोपीज एज लॉर्ड कृष्णा हिमसेल्फ एडमिट्स. सो दिस इज आवर डिवोटी समटाइम्स डिफीट्स कृष्णा. ही मेक्स कृष्णा गिव अप हिज ओन प्रॉमिस. भीष्मदेव ऑल्सो डिड दैट. गोपीज ऑल्सो डिड दैट. I mean, the determination of Krishna is, see, it looks like, oh, Krishna gave up his promise, or he cannot repay, or, you know, Bhishmadev easily could change his mind. Oh, he said, I will not take any weapons, and then Bhishma easily forced him to take weapon. See, it's not easy. Nobody can shake the determination of Krishna. He's like the mountain. Mountain, how much ever you beat or whatever you try, the mountain is not going to move. So, his determination is like millions of mountains together. Nobody can shake such determination. But a devotee easily can be able to do that by his love. The example is given, like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He is very, very grave, like the ocean. An ocean is a very, very powerful feature of nature. Extremely powerful, right? And is very, very deep and grave. It's not going to be excited by all the rivers that are coming into it. Now, there are thousands of rivers that are pouring into the ocean. But the ocean is not going to get excited and swelled up and, you know, it's like, oh, become, you know, overflooding everything. No. The ocean will remain. It's so grave that any amount of agitation that the ocean may receive from various sources, the ocean is not agitated and the ocean does not swell up. But as grave as it is, it will rise when there is a moon, full moon. It will rise like anything. Several feet, several meters it will rise. So, that is compared with the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's condition. He was very, very grave, but when the moon of Krishna, the thought of Krishna comes to his mind, or when he is actually tasting the Radharani's love, at that time he becomes agitated, like an ocean becomes agitated by the moon. You know? So Krishna also, his determination is as deep as the ocean and nobody can shake it. But the moon of love of the devotees, especially like the gopis, I mean at this level, they shake an ocean even. This is the famous verse.
न पारयेहं निरवध्य संयुजा स्वसाधु कृत्यं विबुधायुषापि वः यामा भजन् दुर्जयगेह श्रृंखला यामा भजन् दुर्जयगेह श्रृंखला संवृश्च तद्व प्रतियातु साधुना।
ओ गोपीज, आई एम नॉट एबल टू रिपे माई डेट फॉर योर स्पॉटलेस सर्विस इवन विद इन लाइफ टाइम ऑफ ब्रह्मा। Your connection with me is beyond reproach. You have worshipped me, cutting off all domestic ties, which are difficult to break. Therefore, please let your own glorious deeds be your compensation. Now, if you actually objectively look at this, okay, completely objectively, like without taking the love into consideration, just look at the magnitude. Now, Krishna, he has been providing for us and taking care of us, I mean, since time immemorial, when we were in the spiritual world, and even when we were stupid enough to come into this material world and spend trillions of lifetimes here, still he has been with us. Now, after he has done all these things for us, if we fully surrender our life to him without any reservation, like this, another verse I'll show you. 9465
येदारागार पुत्राप्त प्राणान्वित्तमिमं परं हित्वा मां शरणं याता कथं तां त्यक्तुमुत्सहे।
सिंस प्योर डिवोटीज गिव अप देयर होम्स, वाइव्स, चिल्ड्रन, रिलेटिव्स, रिचेस एंड इवन देयर लाइव्स सिंपली टू सर्व मी विदाउट एनी डिजायर फॉर मटेरियल इंप्रूवमेंट इन दिस लाइफ और इन द नेक्स्ट, हाउ कैन आई गिव अप सच डिवोटीज एट एनी टाइम? So, for all that Krishna has done for us, if we give up everything and surrender to Krishna, is that a thing that he cannot repay? Indeed, it's the other way around. We cannot repay, even if we give our entire life to Krishna, for all that he has done for us, and despite our dog obstinacy of remaining in this material world and staying averse to him, he has made innumerable attempts to change our opinion about him for our own good. He has come millions of times, Sambhavami Yuge Yuge, and he sends his devotees as acharyas in this material world, and he leaves behind scriptures. So much effort is going on his end for our benefit, for our purification. He is endeavoring like anything to get us back to the spiritual world, and we are not in the least interested. Okay? We have been in this material world completely averse and even criticizing God. We have been atheists for many, many lifetimes, and despite all that, he has been taking care of us. Nobody, how can we even repay such love from Krishna? We cannot repay. So if now Krishna is saying to the gopis that you have left all your family connections and everything you have given up, and therefore I cannot repay you your love. Technically speaking, not talking about love, not talking about the devotion, such a sacrifice by a person, like giving up all kinds of family attachments and everything and giving and going to Krishna, is it a big sacrifice? In fact, it is just coming back to senses. If one is illusioned by thinking, oh, this is my family and this man, then he is stupid, he is mad. So if one is out of madness, if one has come out of his madness, is that something you will become indebted with? No. But you see how Krishna considers that. It is impossible that we can repay Krishna. Impossible. But he considers himself incapable to repay such a debt. That is his greatness. That is his gentleness. That is a verse here in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Beautiful verse. Bhrityasya pashyati guru na pina paradhan shreyam managa pikrit. Sorry, shreyam, not shreyam. What is that? भृत्यस्य पश्यति गुरुन बिनापराधान सेवां मनागपि कृतां बहुधा व्युपैति।
आविष्करोति पिशुनेष्वपिनाभ्यसूयां शीलेन निर्मलमतिः पुरुषोत्तमोऽयम्।
यू सी दिस वर्ड, सेवां मनागपि कृतां बहुदाभ्युपैति। मनागपि मीन्स हाउ एवर स्मॉल सर्विस वन डज, बहुधाभ्युपैति, ही एक्सेप्ट्स इट एज वेरी ग्रेट। सो द सुप्रीम पर्सनालिटी ऑफ गॉड, हु इज नोन एज पुरुषोत्तम, द ग्रेटेस्ट ऑफ ऑल पर्सन्स, हैज अ प्योर माइंड, ही इज सो जेंटल दैट इवन इफ हिज सर्वेंट इज इम्प्लिकेटेड इन अ ग्रेट ऑफेंस, ही डज नॉट टेक इट वेरी सीरियसली। इंडीड, इफ हिज सर्वेंट रेंडर्स सम स्मॉल सर्विस, द लॉर्ड एक्सेप्ट्स इट एज बीइंग वेरी ग्रेट। Even if an envious person blasphemes the Lord never manifests anger against him. Such are his great qualities. Now we may say, however small, no, this is not small to give up everything for Krishna. For him it is small. Like Vasudev Datta, he said to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that you give to me all the sins of these people of the all the souls of this universe and you take them back to Godhead, I will suffer for them here. I can't see them suffering. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, what difference is going to make if all the people of this universe, all the souls of this universe are delivered? This universe is just one small mustard seed in a bag of mustard seeds, which is like millions and trillions of mustard seeds. In that day, if one mustard seed is taken out, is it not going to make any difference? It's almost nil. That much, you know, this whole universe itself is like an insignificant mustard seed. And who are we in that universe? And if we serve the Lord with our entire life, is it like a huge thing that he cannot repay? He can. I mean, we cannot repay for what the Lord has done for us all this while. We cannot repay. And Krishna also says in the Bhagavad Gita, if there is no servant dear to me than he who preaches my message. And preaching is for what? For purifying souls and, you know, make them devotees and rid them of all sinful actions. So Vasudev Datta is such a great preacher that he wanted to take everybody's sins, and he wanted, that is the heart of a preacher. He wanted to see the whole universe empty because he wanted everyone to go back to Krishna. But so Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, how significant is that? I mean, if a mustard seed is lost, that means if one becomes a preacher so great that he delivers the entire universe. The camera is shaking. Because the camera is attached to the table. Anyway, so if one becomes a preacher so great that he can deliver the entire universe, even then it is insignificant. It's like a mustard seed in a bag of mustard seeds. Is that a great service? No. Even if one has preached to the entire universe and made them devotees and, you know, took them back to Godhead. So we should never think, oh, we have done something very, very great. You know, I have done this service, Prabhu. I have made, three devotees. Or I sold 100 Bhagavad Gitas. 100. There are trillions of souls in the universe and 100 Bhagavad Gitas only went out. And after, even if the trillions of Bhagavad Gitas went out and the universe became empty by everybody reading Bhagavad Gita and going back to Godhead, for Krishna it is nothing. Absolutely nothing. But still Krishna says that there is no servant dear to me in this world than a preacher of my message. That is Krishna's gentle behavior or Krishna's greatness, that he accepts sevam managapikritam bahudabhyupaiti. Even a devotee, Srila Prabhupada also was like that. If a devotee offers him some garland or some flower or any small thing, he used to accept it very fondly. He used to accept. Sometimes, you know, some devotees used to offer him precious rings, very precious rings. And I mean, sannyasi, what he will do with the ring? But he will accept. It's not that, no, I don't wear rings, I'm a sannyasi, you cannot give me. No, it is not the offering, it is the devotion with which they offered him, right? Of course, if they offer him meat, then he will of course slap them, but they offered him some ring. So, he took it and he wore also. Then, when some devotee is getting married, he will give the ring to them. And then they wear as a wedding ring. So, as a Prabhupada's prasadam, you know, like that. So, Mahaprasad ring. So, like that he used to give away. So, he used to accept and give away. So, you know, నిర్మలమతి శైలేన జెంటుల్ నిర్మలమతి మైల్డ్ అండ్ హీ యాక్సెప్ట్స్ ఎవ్రీథింగ్ సో కృష్ణ ఆల్సో హీ యాక్సెప్ట్స్ అవర్ స్మాల్ సర్వీస్ యాజ్ ఇఫ్ ఇట్స్ వెరీ గ్రేట్ అండ్ కృష్ణ కన్సిడర్స్ హిమ్సెల్ఫ్ ఈవెన్ ఇన్ ద లైఫ్ టైమ్ ఆఫ్ బ్రహ్మ యూ సీ హౌ వాట్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ వర్డ్స్ కృష్ణ యూస్డ్ ఐ మీన్ లుక్ ఎట్ దిస్ ఈవెన్ ఇన్ ద లైఫ్ టైమ్ ఆఫ్ బ్రహ్మ ఐ కెనాట్ రీపే యువర్ డెట్ జస్ట్ ఫర్ గివింగ్ అప్ ఫ్యామిలీ కనెక్షన్స్ ఫర్ హీమ్ కృష్ణ యాక్సెప్ట్స్ ఇట్ యాజ్ వెరీ గ్రేట్ బట్ ఇఫ్ యూ అబ్జెక్టివ్లీ లుక్ ఎట్ ఇట్ ఇట్ ఇస్ నథింగ్ ఫర్ ఇన్ కంపారిజన్ విత్ వాట్ కృష్ణ హెస్ డన్ ఫర్ అస్ సీ దట్స్ కృష్ణస్ గ్రేట్నెస్ దట్ హీ కన్సిడర్స్ హిమ్సెల్ఫ్ unable to repay.
Tabe je dekhiye gopir nija dehe preet, seho ta krishner lagi jani ho nischit.
Now, whatever affection we see the gopis show off, whatever affection we see the gopis show for their own bodies, know it for certain to be only for the sake of Krishna. This is another thing. What is the time now? Oh, we're almost close to 10. How far can we go? Okay, we'll read a little more. So, here is a great difference again. The women of this world, they make up and look nice and everything. They want to look nice. And they post their photos on Instagram, Facebook, WhatsApp, profile picture. So, in this way, they take care of their body, decorate their bodies for own gratification. But gopis also similarly do the same thing. They also decorate themselves very exquisitely, very nicely, very beautiful. But they do so for Krishna because they want Krishna to be happy when he sees them. It's not that they want to enjoy Krishna. Of course, a woman also, like in this material world, a woman wants to dress in a way to attract a man. She wants to make the man happy when he looks at her, so that eventually she can have him and she can enjoy that attention first of all, and then she can have that man, you know, this kind of things. This kind of lusty affairs go on in this material world. But the gopis never wanted to enjoy Krishna. Of course, when Krishna reciprocates, it's, it's enjoyment. But they don't look for such reciprocation. Their quality of devotion does not change whether Krishna reciprocates or not. It doesn't change. Whereas here in this world, when there's no reciprocation, the person becomes frustrated. So in the case of gopis, they don't look for such reciprocation. They just want Krishna to be happy. So Krishna, if he sees us well dressed and nicely ornamented, if that brings him happiness, yes, they will do it. So whatever affection we see the gopis show for their own bodies, know it for certain to be only for the sake of Lord Krishna. And another thing is, we have to understand that our body, now we are not on the level of gopis, you know, that we are, you know, decorating ourselves so Krishna will see us. Now, in our level where we are at third class devotees, at least I am. So, at this level, how can we understand this? Now, our own bodies, we have to understand that this is Krishna's property. This body, I did not create it. Of course, my actions, I have been awarded this body, but Krishna created this body. It's his property. So just like the gopis show their, you know, decorated their bodies for Krishna's satisfaction, we have to decorate our bodies according to Krishna's satisfaction. That's why we have tilak. This is a kind of cosmetics, right? So for the devotee, the kantimala, the tilak, and devotional attire, these are all necessary. Why? Because our body is not our body. It is Krishna's body. And we have to, wear and, put tilak and everything for Krishna's satisfaction. Sometimes some people say, I don't want to show off that I'm a devotee. After all, it's the heart that matters, no? How does it matter whether I dress in a devotional way or non-devotional way? So, the thing is, they're thinking it's still their body. Oh, it is after all the heart. So, if the heart is always thinking of Krishna, it's like the gopis. They also dress their body and they decorated their body also according to what Krishna wants. Heart means not only heart and not the body. तन मन धन एज वे से मीन्स बॉडी वेल्थ एंड लाइफ एवरीथिंग. सो यद व्हाट इज दैट तनुवाक मनोभिर बॉडी माइंड एंड वर्ड्स एवरीथिंग शुड बी इफ नॉट ओनली द हार्ट एंड देन द माइंड एंड वर्ड्स आर डूइंग समथिंग एल्स बॉडी डूइंग समथिंग एल्स बॉडी ड्रेसिंग लाइक व्हाट इज दैट डिस्को डांसर हार्ट हरे कृष्णा इज दैट. So we have to dress also according to what Krishna wants. See, because his body is meant for Krishna's satisfaction. That's why actually there is a nice incident. Sanatan Goswami, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he saw Sanatan Goswami, because Sanatan Goswami was coming to see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and on the way he Tapan Mishra, he offered him a nice shawl, you know, woolen shawl decorated, nice design, full, looked very opulent. So when he took that and went to see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did not like it. He did not say anything, but he just looked at the shawl every now and then. He did not say, but Sanatana Goswami got the indication. Okay, I think Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is not happy with what I am wearing. So then he went to beach near the shore, bank of river Ganga. There he found a poor Brahmana, very poor. He was wearing a shawl which is torn, like rags, he was basically like a rag. So then Sanatana Goswami went to him and said, oh, shall we exchange our shawls? And the Brahmana felt a little bit offended. So, you are making fun of me? You are making fun of me? And Sanatana Goswami said, no, I am serious. You give me your shawl, you take mine. Really? Yes, please give me. And he gave his own shawl and took. Oh, Brahmana was surprised. Oh, what happened? But Sanatana Goswami went back with his used shawl, which was also torn. And when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw that, he was very happy. So again, dressing for the pleasure of Krishna. Why Krishna, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was pleased when he was wearing a torn shawl? Because, then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw that, because you are a renunciate, this dress is suitable. Don't wear too opulent, so that you attract unnecessary attention or you are still bodily concept or what are you trying to say? So that's what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu meant by those looks at the expensive shawl. So when he used the shawl which is torn, then he is happy. Okay, now you are properly situated in your position. So purport, the selfless love of Godhead exhibited by the gopis cannot have any parallel. We should not therefore misunderstand the carefulness of the gopis in their personal decoration. The gopis dress themselves as beautifully as possible just to make Krishna happy by seeing them. They had no ulterior desires. They dedicated their bodies and everything they possessed to the service of Sri Krishna, taking it for granted that their bodies were meant for his enjoyment. They dressed themselves with the understanding that Krishna would be happy by seeing and touching them. In fact, in the Chaitanya Leela, there is also Ramanandaraya. Yes. So he was so elevated. Was Ramanandaraya? Yeah, it was Ramanandaraya. So, he was so elevated that he was training the dancers of Jagannath. So, they were, what are they called? They're called some, there is a name for them. So, these girls, they are unmarried and their life is just dedicated to perform dramatic dances in front of Lord Jagannath in the Jagannath temple. And Ramanandara used to train them up. And he used to train them up. And he used to also bathe them and decorate them. But he was not Devadasis. Correct. Thank you, Virendra Prabhu. Devadasis. So, they are the ones. So, he used to bathe them. And bathe them means he used to see all their private parts and everything. He used to carefully, wash their bodies and decorate them and clothe them. Everything. A man doing that for women in this world. Nobody can do that without being agitated. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said,
my mind becomes agitated when I touch a wooden doll of a woman. You know, he said that. I mean, of course, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mind is not going to be agitated, but he said that to instruct us that even when I hear the name of a woman, my mind is already a little bit changed. You know, I feel a kind of attraction. That is how strong lust is in this material world. You know, like even when one is in devotional service, like Prabhupada explained, that he may be chanting Radhe, Radhe, and then he is thinking of the neighbor Radha. Or he may be doing Aarti and he must be thinking of that colleague Aarti. Or he must be doing puja for Krishna and thinking of some puja in the school, classmate. Or he is doing, what is that? Deepa. And he is thinking of some Deepika somewhere. So there is so many in the Pushpa. You can offer Pushpa to Krishna and then thinking of another Pushpa somewhere. So many, you know, seemingly. Or he may be speaking about Gita. Gita Jayanti. Oh, Gita Pravachan. But he is thinking of another Gita somewhere. So all these things can happen. You know. So the attraction. Where is our attraction? That is very important. No ulterior desires. Now, even though one may be in devotional service, there may be many ulterior desires until one is completely purified. See? But, so Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is teaching us. Of course, he is not in that position. He is a Supreme Personality. How can his heart be agitated when a woman's name is taken? No. But he is teaching us how to be strict. Now, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, even I cannot do this, but only Ramanandraya is the only person in the universe who can bathe a woman like that and, you know, dress them up and train them in and decorate their bodies and train them in dancing for Jagannath and not be even the slightest, not having the slightest agitation. That is only possible for Ramanandraya. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that. The whole, what is that? Whole episode is there in the, I forget the chapter somewhere, it is there. So, that, you know, this is, again, the gopis also think, looks like they are, you know, decorating their bodies and everything, but actually only for Krishna's sake. And Ramanandara also only for Jagannath's satisfaction. It's a very high stage of devotion, not to be imitated at all. You try to imitate, finish, the person will fall miserably. Ei deha kailu ami krishne samarpan taradhana tara iha sambhoga sadhan. The gopis think, I have offered this body to Krishna, Lord Krishna. He is its owner and it brings him enjoyment. So how our body can be used for Krishna's enjoyment? Engage in his service. Not that we put nice makeup and say, Prabhu, actually I am thinking like gopi. So that when Krishna, when I go to see Krishna darshan, Krishna will take my darshan and, you know, he will be happy. Please. We cannot, in the name of Krishna, in the name of Lord Gopis, then dress ourselves nicely, too much, you know, and then go in front of course, I mean, reasonably one must be well dressed, and of course, we are not, you know, advised to wear torn clothing and all that, like Sanatan Goswami, but but decently, but not like, you know, overdoing everything and then, oh, I'm actually dressing myself because Krishna, when he sees me, instead of I taking darshan of Krishna, Krishna will take darshan of me. That is stupidity. E deha darshana sparshe Krishna santoshan, e lagi kare dehara marjana bhushan. Krishna finds joy in seeing and touching this body. It is for this reason that they cleanse and decorate their bodies. Nijangamapi yagopyo mameti samupasate tabhyah param name partha nigudha prema bhajanam. O Arjuna, there are no greater receptacles of deep love for me than the gopis, who cleanse and decorate their bodies because they consider them mine. This verse is spoken by Lord Krishna in the Adi Puran. So there is a conversation between Krishna and Arjuna in the Adi Puran. So there it is mentioned here.
Krishna is glorifying the gopis to Arjuna.
Arekadbhuta gopi bhaver swabhav buddhir gocharna hai ja buddhir gocharna hai jahara prabhav.
There is another wonderful feature of the emotion of the gopis. Its power is beyond the comprehension of the intelligence. And I think it's beyond our time limit already. So I think probably. Okay, we will actually finish this up. The gopis, okay. Oh, what is that? Yeah.
गोपी गण करे जबे कृष्ण दर्शन सुख वांछना ही सुख होए कोटि गुण.
When the gopis see Lord Krishna, they derive unbounded bliss, although they have no desire for such pleasure. They don't want to be happy by seeing Krishna. It's not that they want some sense gratification from seeing Krishna. But they just want to use their eyes to see Him because their eyes are meant to see Him. But in the activity of doing that, they get pleasure. In the gopis see Lord Krishna, they derive unbounded bliss, although they have no desire for such pleasure.
Gopika darshane krishner je anand hoy taha hoyte koti gun gopi aswadoy.
The gopis taste a pleasure 10 million times greater than the pleasure Lord Krishna derives from seeing them. The wonderful characteristics of the gopis are beyond imagination. Purport. They have no desire for personal satisfaction, yet when Krishna is happy by seeing them, that happiness of Krishna makes the gopis a million times more happy than Krishna himself. This is why Radharani is considered greater than Krishna, especially by Vrindavan Vasis. Because what Radharani knows or what Radharani feels, the happiness, is greater than what Krishna feels, not just by a little bit, by 10,000 or 10 million times.
तास बार नाही निज सुख अनुरोध तथापि बाढ़ये सुख पड़िल विरोध.
The gopis have no inclination for their own enjoyment and yet their joy increases. That is indeed a contradiction.
ए विरोधेर एकमात्र देखी समाधान गोपिकार सुख कृष्ण सुखे पर्यवसान.
For this contradiction, I see only one solution. The joy of the gopis lies in the joy of their beloved Krishna. That is the only way we can explain this. Purport. The situation of the gopis is perplexing, for although they did not want personal happiness, it was imposed upon them. Here in the material world, we don't want suffering, but it is imposed upon us. But in the spiritual world, they don't want personal happiness, but it was imposed upon them. Complete opposite. The solution of this perplexity is that Sri Krishna's sense of happiness is limited by the happiness of the gopis. Devotees at Vrindavan therefore try to serve the gopis, namely Radharani and her associates. If one gains the favor of the gopis, he easily gains the favor of Krishna, because on the recommendation of the gopis, Krishna at once accepts the service of a devotee. Lord Chaitanya therefore wanted to please the gopis instead of Krishna, but his contemporaries misunderstood him, and for this reason Lord Chaitanya renounced the order of the householder life and became a sannyasi. You know this incident? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, while he was grihastha, his mother asked him to marry a second time after his first wife passed away, very young age. And then he married. But within months of his marriage, as he was sitting at one place and chanting, instead of Hare Krishna, he was chanting gopis' names. Of course, we are not. Prabhu, tomorrow I will also start, because I think, you know, here it is said, gopis, Krishna will be more happy if we worship gopis. Okay, tomorrow, Prabhu, I am chanting the 108 gopis' names on my beads. Please. We have to follow the order of the spiritual master. We cannot imitate Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. But when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself does that, who has the audacity to correct him? But there were some people like that at the time who were trying to correct him. Oh, why are you chanting gopis' names? You should chant Krishna's name. They were advising Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And they criticized him. Oh, he is doing something else, you know, he's chanting gopis' names. What is this? And therefore, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took sannyas. What is the connection? Connection is that if he takes sannyas, people, see, he thought like this, that, see, I have come here to distribute the holy name and give the easiest way for liberation. easiest way for liberation to these conditioned souls. And if they reject even me, if they criticize me, if they do not accept my shelter, there is no other way these poor souls are going to be helped. So, whether they like it or not, a sannyasi should always be given respects. Whether they agree with the sannyasi or not agree, the sannyasi should be given respect. So, whether they agree with me or not, I want them to respect me. Because, not because he is a narcissist, but because he thought that only that way they can actually be delivered. Because in Bhagavatam it is said, Yajanti hi sumedhasaha krishnavarnam dvishakrishnam. So, those who worship Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they are the most intelligent. So, because some people are criticizing Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, so therefore, he wanted to see Krishna, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is thinking in this way that how I can turn them into devotees or at least force them to offer their respects to me so that they will be benefited. That's how he thought, and he used this trick of, okay, let me take sannyas. Because if I take sannyas, everybody must respect me and that way they will be benefited. So, whether they agree with me or not. So, in that way, he took sannyas ashram. Prabhupada called this a trick. He tricked his sannyas ashram was a trick to trick the people into devotional service. Just like Buddha also tricked people. Gopika darshane krishner badhe prafullata shema dhurya badhe jaran nahika samata. When Lord Krishna sees the gopis, his joy increases and his unparalleled sweetness increases also. See, a person becomes more sweet when the person is joyful. You don't want to see a person's long face, right? That's not very sweet to see. So, when one is joyful, if you see that person, oh, you also become joyful. Your person will appear sweet. So, you know, that like that. So, similarly, when Lord Krishna sees the gopis, they dress themselves and decorate themselves so that Krishna will be happy. And when Krishna sees the gopis like that, his joy increases. And how come his joy is dependent on the gopis' dressing? Or, in other case, he stole their dresses and saw them naked. So, how come he is dependent on... No, again, he is not dependent on them. He is also just reciprocating their love. Because they want to love Krishna as a gopi, he will become a perfect lover. And lover means, you know, he will do all these things. He will want to see the beloved naked and all these things are there. So, he will reciprocate perfectly. And seeing the devotion of the devotee, Krishna becomes joyful. And when the joy increases, his unparalleled sweetness, it's already unparalleled, infinite sweetness, that increases even more. Then what happens?
Amara darshane Krishna paila eta sukha, e sukhe gopira prafulla anga mukha.
The gopis think Krishna has obtained so much pleasure by seeing me. That thought increases the fullness and beauty of their faces and bodies. Again, because Krishna is happy, they become happy. And then when they become happy, they also appear even more sweeter. And seeing their sweetness, Krishna becomes happy. And he becomes even more sweeter. And seeing that sweetness, increased sweetness, their happiness grows. And like this, there is competition. And it never ends.
Gopi shobha dekhi krishner shobha badhe jata, krishna shobha dekhi gopir shobha badhe tata.
The beauty of Lord Krishna increases at the sight of the beauty of the gopis. And the more the gopis see Lord Krishna's beauty, the more their beauty increases.
Eimata paraspara pade huda hudi, paraspara badhe keho mukha nahi mudi.
In this way, competition takes place between them in which no one acknowledges defeat.
Kintu krishner sukha hoy gopi rupa gune, tara sukhe sukha vriddhi hoy gopi gane.
Krishna, however, derives pleasure from the beauty and good qualities of the gopis. And when the gopis see his pleasure, the joy of the gopis increases.
Ata eva she sukha krishna sukha poshe, ehe tu gopi preme nahi kama doshe.
Therefore, we find that the joy of the gopi nourishes the joy of Lord Krishna. For that reason, the fault of lust is not present in their love. So this is the way the dealings are going on in the spiritual world. It is not at all lust, where it is all about their own happiness. Lust is all about one's own happiness. Whereas Gopi is not interested in their happiness, and Krishna is also interested only in the gopis, and he's also not interested in his own happiness. So in this way, but as much as they don't are not interested in their own happinesses, they become more and more happy. That's the contradiction, transcendental contradiction. So purport: by looking at the beautiful gopis, Krishna becomes enlivened, and this enlivens the gopis whose youthful faces and bodies blossom. This competition of increasing beauty between the gopis and Krishna, which is without limitations, is so delicate that sometimes mundane moralists mistake these dealings to be purely amorous. But these affairs are not at all mundane, because the gopis' intense desire to satisfy Krishna surcharges the entire scene with pure love of Godhead, with not a spot of sexual indulgence. Stavamala, Keshavashtaka. Wow, what is this? उपेत्यपथि सुंदरी ततिभिर् आभिर् अभ्यर्चितम् 17 उपेत्यपथि सुंदरी ततिभिर् आभिर् अभ्यर्चितम् स्मितांकुरकरं वितय नो सर उपेत्यपथि सुंदरी ततिभिराभिर् अभ्यर्चितम् स्मितांकुरकरं वितैर्नटदापांगभंगिशतै स्तनस्तवकसञ्चरन्नयनचञ्चरीकञ्चलम् व्रजे विजयिनं भजे विपिनदेशतः केशवम्. I don't know, not exactly the tune, but just somehow fitted there. Translation: I worship Lord Keshava. Coming back from the forest of Vraja, he is worshipped by the gopis, who mount the roofs of their palaces and meet him on the path with 100 manners of dancing glances and gentle smiles. The corners of his eyes wander like large black bees around the gopis' breasts. This statement appears in the Keshavashtaka of the Stavamala, compiled by Srila Rupa Goswami. So this actually looks like a mundane, you know, lusty scene, but not at all. That's why we are not allowed to enter into these topics, because we are not sufficiently advanced. That's why Prabhupada forbade us to enter too much. Of course, these verses are mentioned here, so we just are reading them. But we are not supposed to go deep into them, because we will easily misunderstand these things. Areka gopi preme swabhavika chihna je prakare hoy prema kama gandhahina. There is another natural symptom of the gopi's love that shows it to be without a trace of lust. So this one we will do it in the next session. So if you have any questions, we will take any questions now. Okay, I think we have Virendra. In Kurukshetra war, the Kauravas, the soldiers who died, attained the salvation due to presence of Krishna. Demons also attained salvation which were killed by Lord Krishna. My question is, how were the Kauravas, soldiers who died in Kurukshetra war, and demons who were all irreligious, performed sinful karma, achieved spiritual world instead of going to hell, whereas Kali Yuga people are not given such a chance? Only those who perform bhakti and chant holy names attain spiritual world in Kali Yuga. See, Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha, I mean Jayavijay, they were actually devotees, right? Then they became demons. So here, whoever is demon who is fighting with Krishna, who is there when Krishna is there, Can an ordinary demon actually come in front of Krishna like that? Yeah, and fight with him and be killed by him? Is an ordinary demon? No. There have to be some great personalities who took the part of demons in his Leela. You see? Just like Jay and Vijay took the part of demons. Not actually demons. You should understand these things. Next question by Virendra. When sage Bhrigu, see, okay, continuing the last question. So, when the devotees play the part of demons in the Krishna's pastimes, he is teaching us how not to be demons. Now, Krishna personally killed the demons and he showed how being demonic is bad and they will be killed by the power of Krishna. But actual demons who are really rascals, who when they do something nonsense, it's not that Krishna will personally come and actually kill them. They will be killed by nature. You know, many nature has many tools in her toolbox to kill us. One of those tools is sufficient. So, it happens by the will of the anger of Krishna, but through the agency of material nature. But when Krishna personally does, that's different. Virendra. Next question. When sage Bhrigu kicked the heart of Vishnu, Lakshmi angrily left Vaikuntha and settled in Kolhapur on the earthly planet. Lord Vishnu in search of Lakshmi left Vaikuntha and came to Tirupati as Lord Venkateshwar. So, is this pastime of Lakshmi Narayan and whether Lakshmi Narayan ever leave Vaikuntha? They leave and they don't leave also. See, when they... Come on, this much you must understand about Krishna. When he leaves a place, he is still in that place. It's not like us. Why are you calculating Krishna like your own self? When you leave a room, then you're not in that room. When Krishna leaves the room, he is still in the room. Antar bahiravasthitam Kunti Devi is saying, no? Why? How come that is possible? Antar bahiravasthitam. He is inside and outside. He is inside the heart. Then he is outside also. Did he leave the heart? No. He is there in the heart also. Vrindavanam parityajya padamekam na gacchati. He does not leave the Vrindavan even for a moment. But he left. But still he was in Vrindavan. If he was not there, they would not have lived. The gopis and all the Vrindavan vasis. So we should not calculate Krishna like us. When he has left a place, he is not there anymore. He is still there. Andantarastha paramanushayantarastham. In every single atom. Next question by Bhakta Virendra. Did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu disappear by merging himself in the deity of Lord Jagannath? That is what is stated. Anyway, how does it concern you? How does it concern in today's topic? Nothing concerning to today's topic. Ask some relevant questions. No? Virendra Ekbote. Again, next question. All by Virendra only. Okay. Is Manmana Bhava Madbhakto verse which comes twice in Bhagavad Gita a practical application of Sarvadharman Parityajya verse? Yeah. Always think of Krishna. That is the practical application of Sarvadharman Parityajya. Correct. Virendra again. Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb was a staunch Muslim who worshipped Allah. Did Lord Krishna punish him for his sinful karma of destroying Krishna temples of Vrindavan? A staunch worshipper of God will never decry other methods of worship. And if one does, that means he is not a staunch worshipper. if he is a staunch worshipper, he should respect God in every aspect of his. If he does not, that means he is not a staunch worshipper. Because we are worshipping the same God that he is worshipping. But if he breaks all these things, that means he has not understood what is God consciousness. Such people will definitely be punished. Next question by Sunita Sharma. Hare Krishna, you mentioned that Krishna does not know the heart of Radha. Does Krishna know the hearts of his devotees in Golok Vrindavan? Yes, he knows. Krishna knows also the heart of Radharani in the form of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, you see, as I said in the previous session, it appears like Krishna does not know the heart of Radharani. Like he is not incapable or is not capable of something. but then he make himself capable. Momentarily it may seem like, wow, this is the same incident is there in when Aghasur, you know, that snake demon came and he opened his mouth wide, you know, huge snake. It was like when he opened his mouth wide, it was like a huge cave, you know, mountain cave. And he was lying like that, waiting to capture Krishna and eat him. So Kamsa sent this Aghasura and he came in the form of the snake. Now, when the snake came and all the cowherd boyfriends of Krishna along with the cows and everybody, they were happily going into the mouth of that demon. They were saying to themselves, hey, look at this, some new mountain is here. If a new mountain is there, something is wrong, right? That's not a, how can a mountain, new mountain come suddenly on the path? I mean, come on. So, but the boys were excited. Hey, new mountain, new cave. They were going to the same forest every time, but suddenly found a new cave and they were excited. You should be afraid, right? But you see, they were excited because they were confident. Whatever happens, Krishna is there. So, hey, come. Hey, this is a beautiful mountain, new mountain we never seen before. New cave. Go inside. Then Krishna, when he saw that, he became startled for a moment. He said, wow, the power of Maya is so powerful that one eagerly accepts danger as if it's a source of enjoyment. And that's how the materialists are actually doing. They risk their lives for sense gratification. They actually are in so much danger. I mean, even a commute has, of course, it doesn't look so dangerous, but so many road accidents happen, right? So, actually, it is dangerous on the road. And even otherwise, some occupations are, by nature, they are dangerous. The occupation itself is dangerous. So, they risk so much for sense gratification. So, when Krishna was looking at the cowherd boys and everybody going into the mouth of Aghasura, he wondered at the power of his illusory energy. But then, within a moment, he also went inside to teach the Aghasura lesson. So, momentarily, Krishna may accept a different emotion. How can Krishna be startled by his own Maya? It's his under his control, right? Even if it controls so many people, it is under his order that she is controlling so many people and keeping them bewildered. But still, he is surprised, or that surprise, I mean, he is a reservoir of all emotions. So, surprise and all these things are also in him. So, when he wants to manifest that, he will manifest. So, similarly, it appears that he could not understand Radharani, but he did understand her by his incarnation as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, similarly, he will know all the hearts. Of course, this is only for Radharani. Other devotees, Radharani is the topmost devotee. She is actually equal to him. She is a female counterpart of Krishna. Whereas everybody else is lower than her. Krishna understands everybody's heart, of course. Okay, anything else? No more questions. Thank you very much for attending, giving us a chance to speak about Radha Krishna and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, although we are completely unqualified. Thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki jai, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ki jai, Shri Shri Radha Madan Mohan ki jai, Ananta Kodi Vaishnav Vrind ki jai, Nitai Gaur Premanande, Hari Hari Bol, Hare Krishna.